We just put on our phones, you know, just, yeah. Names or anything. Arise, O compatriots, Nigeria's call, obey to serve our Father.
Yeah, that's way much, way, way better. So we're going to talk about the social media bill. It's not called the social media bill, technically, but it affects us and it affects social media, and it's important. And it's very important that as we start the conversation, that we put it in context of why it's important. And the reason why it's important is because if you're paying attention, it almost seems as if there is a deliberate plan to gradually cut at every edge of free space that citizens have. There's something I heard yesterday. Now, there's a bill that passed, it's now a law, the Cyber Act, the Cyber Crime. We know what cyber crime is targeted at, right? Right now, there's somebody in jail for 7 years as convicted under the Cybercrime Act, and their crime was for criticizing the government. Now, here's the point. The point is that it seems like they're gradually, from every side, we don't want people to criticize the government. We don't want people to say that people are stealing money. We don't want videos of governors to come out holding dollar in their hand. We don't want videos of senators coming out beating people up. We want to be able to shut down the internet. We want to be able to censor you. We don't want young people to be able to protest, to say the government is not doing a good job. And I don't know how many of you guys were alive, because I can see some young people, but during the last time when we were not a democracy, I remember watching news every day and seeing young people celebrating the president there. He's no longer alive, so I'll say his name at some point, but the president then, and every day on the news they said, the youth of Nigeria are so happy and we want this guy to stop being a military president and be a democratic president. And I remember how it felt. I remember how it felt that time that people's fathers were getting picked up and sent to jail and disappearing. People are nodding. I don't know if you guys remember how it felt. And if there's an argument, ever an argument, that God is real, it is that a week to the time that this person died, he had called for national prayers for the future of Nigeria. And 1 week later, I don't know if you guys remember that, but 1 week later, he said Muslims and Christians should pray. 1 week later, he died. But even in that sequence of things, the people in government that could have even stood against him were brought up on treason charges and were all taken to court in justice, and they were speeding through the trial like this. And it feels like deja vu. So we can't start everywhere, but we can start with the thing that touches us directly at our doorstep, which is social media. This ridiculous piece of legislation that has been put forth by the Senate that says, using the trapdoor of fake news, using the trapdoor of fake news that says that The government needs the power to do what it takes to shut down fake news. I asked a question, and I don't want to speak too much because people are going to come up and they're going to speak and give us perspective. But the other day, the EFCC handle called out a media, I think it was the cable NG, and told them that they were spreading fake news for saying something that the chairman said. Did anybody see that online? They basically said that the chairman said that coronavirus was because of corruption. Yes, that coronavirus is a product of corruption. Hey, let me not spread fake news now. But when they said it, then the EFCC handle said, this story is false. Take it down. That is not what the chairman said. But oh my Jesus, there was a video. And the video came out. But it scared me, Dotun. It scared me. You know why it scared me? Because that single tweet, with the law in place, it means a completely different thing. And it doesn't matter whether or not the story is true. Right? I'll give you another instance. The other day, the minister was involved in this fake news story. Now, there are many portions to this story. Number one, somebody had tweeted that the minister was there when there was an attack, and the minister had sped away. And the minister came out and said, it is fake news. Now, I went and did my own research. I'm a little bit sympathetic to the person that tweeted it, and I just wanted to know what was really going on. So my question was, is this a perspective issue? Did something really happen, or was the whole story made up? Now, does anybody know the details of this? If you heard about this situation in Kaduna, can you put your hand up if you know what I'm talking about? Does anybody know if something really happened in Kaduna? Do you know? Now, the reason why is because immediately the fake news came out, everybody that was reporting the story sort of stopped. I think it was Sahara reporters that were very bold and they pushed something out the next day. But from every piece of information that I've seen, there was actually an attack that was coming towards people that left the train on which the minister was. He was actually a passenger on the train. So every single piece of information seems to be true. But the narrative that came back from the government was that this is a fake story and that we need to make sure that this legislation passes. This is literally what he said. He didn't say we're investigating to see if there was actually an attack. He said, I didn't see any attack, so this is fake news and we're going to make sure this bill passes. He didn't say it is terrible if people are attacking the train. Even witnesses that were there that were saying it's fake news said, yes, some people came and they were shooting guns, but they were repelled. Think about that. We were seconds away from lives being lost, from people being kidnapped. And the narrative that's being peddled is that fake news. Let's get the legislation passed so that we can have young people no longer be able to protest. If you're paying attention, they are letting you know that if you talk too loud, we'll get rid of you. You know what I mean? And that's what we're here for. So the first thing I want us to do is to do a little bit of breakdown. We're going to try to make this not too pedantic, not too deep, and not too... Osas is in the building. Ejiro, I see you guys. Please come in. Sit down. We're going to try and break it down and not make it too serious, but just so that people can understand. And we have friends in the building, Osiwa's in the building, EIE is in the building. They're going to help us talk through the bill. But also, again, remember, they're going to try and give us the big picture of why it's important that influential Nigerians start to speak up, because we have to take a stand. We have to put our foot down and say, hey, you're going too far. Let's start going the other way instead. And Kamara, if you can help me, who is helping me? Is it Toda that's coming to discuss? Yes, I know you're on the program. Are you the one that's coming to discuss the bill? Who is? Oh, ha ha ha. She's here. Oh, that's true. I didn't mention her, but I'm going to introduce her. Does she know? She's looking at me like, okay, let me. On my thing, it says Toda Debbie. Who is it? Is it from the person from EIE? Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, she is an iconic Nigerian entertainer for generations. She's been sought after by me. And she's eventually told me it's not going to happen. But we'll see. We'll see. We'll see. Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together as we welcome the legendary Kate Henshaw up.
Hello. Okay, good morning, everyone. I'll just go quickly into it. So on the role of social media in promoting transparency, public accountability, and good governance cannot be overemphasized. It has opened new possibilities for citizens to engage with each other, their political representatives, and contribute towards an inclusive, broad-based political process. So on November 24, 2015, Bala Ilnala, he's a senator from Kebbi South, sponsored a bill to prohibit frivolous petitions and other matters connected therewith. The bill was a guise to restrict freedom of expression and gag Nigerians on social media. After public outcry on the repressive nature of the bill and its infringement on individuals' rights online, the bill was withdrawn May 17, 2016. So, like, almost a year plus later. On Wednesday, July 11th, Mr. Lai Mohammed, you got it, Abby, Minister of Information and Culture, launched a campaign against fake news. I mean, nobody likes fake news. I don't like fake news. On Tuesday, October 29th, Lai Mohammed reiterated government's commitment to regulate social media. Mohammed Sani Musa, Senator Niger East, on Tuesday, November 5th, reintroduced the bill to regulate social media, Protection of Internet Falsehood and Manipulations Bill 2019. Now, this bill affects you if you're an individual, media organization, internet service provider, and a business that uses the internet. The key issues with the bill: one, transmission of false statements of facts. You must not make false statements that diminish public confidence in the performance of any duty or function of or in the exercise of any power by government. This will silence criticism clearly and stifle opposition. If you share an information that can paint the government in bad light, you are guilty. So what if they are guilty and they are doing something bad? We can't speak. Two, jamming the internet. The Nigerian Police Force may direct the Nigerian Communications Commission to order the internet access service provider to take responsible steps to disable access by end users in Nigeria to the online location. If the online location is being used, like, say, over 3 million Nigerians, this implies the online location website, web page, chat room will be denied access because of the sin of one person. Criminalization of misrepresentation of facts. A declaration is false if it is false or misleading, whether wholly or in part, and whether on its own or in the context in which it appears. Different people are likely to imply different things from the same statement, clearly. So why should someone be punished because some set of people misinterpreted an information wrongly? Also, it is unreasonable to interpret a statement on its own, devoid of the context in which it was used. In fact, the Cybercrime Act 2015, which was assented by former President Goodluck Jonathan, was so broad, it provided room for abuse, and Enough is Enough paradigm initiative and media rights agenda are challenging Section 24 of the Act at the Supreme Court. Our existing laws are enough to address all possible crimes in using social media. Why do we need to create new ones to silence dissenting voices? Unless there's something to hide. Thank you.
Thank you, Kate. One of our Egbons that's about to leave wanted to share something with us. Just say a few words. So please, Oga Dede, please let's put our hands together for him. He literally stopped his day, drove all the way from the mainland to be here, to drive back, and I really appreciate you, sir. Thank you.
As I look to now, we will not make the story long too much. I wish I could stay a lot longer, but I have a very important function on the mainland. I'm here because of you. I'm here because I believe that the youth of this country needs to understand what and who they are. So many of us get the social media space to use in this day and age. So many of us get so many people when they follow una. When I get people when get so many likes, people when love them. But how many amongst all of una use the value of this free space we una get for the benefit of your own selves and your future yet unborn? Many a times, many things have been happening in this system. People refuse to think back. In the olden days, now the young ones, when we're there for university, we stand up and fight when things go wrong. We not get social media to use. We had no phones. But we related and we communicated and we reacted the right way around. We fought not because we hated the government, but because we hated those things that were going to become a problem for us and for our own future. It's your time. What thing would they see now? How would all of you just sit down and practically use these wonderful tools you have and do nothing but socialize in a very flippant way? You should empathize with what you are faced with the more. Those who have so many followers, how many of them have you influenced to face the facts of what their rights are? How many of them have you truly spoken to see the essence of what their future holds? We're in a system where these people can hoodwink you because you give them the chance to do it. Check this out, guys. The we the people factor is becoming a jocular thing. We the people, we kept quiet for too long. We the people, we didn't do anything about those things that we have been seeing that are wrong. We the people, we saw them impose themselves upon us. We the people saw these people who are supposed to be serving us now, ruling on us, dominating upon us, compressing everything that is supposed to be humanly sensible, and making us look like animals and jocular idiots to the entire world. Africa needs this country, this unit, to be solid for Africa to stand strong. If this generation is not empowered, what is Africa? What are we? All your fights, all your sweat will go to nothing if you just sit down and continue the way we have been doing. Look, guys, a docile people are like a dead race. We're not calling for violence. We're not saying we should fight them because of what they're doing. We're saying we should educate them now. We're saying you should wake up. It's your right. It's our right. We the people hold the right in a democratic situation to express that which we feel as a people. If we cannot do it right here in this land of ours, I'm sorry, the whole of the black race will be in real deep trouble. It's in our hands. It's in your hands. I keep asking this question. How many of the people in this generation, this so-called young generation now, even watch the news? How many of them watch current affairs programs? How many of them take the time to read newspapers? But you have the social media space you use every day. How many times do you use it to check your history, to check about your culture, the way of your people that should guide your thoughts, that should guide the tenets that rule us and bind us together? Listen, we have been too docile for too long. They have now taken our docility for stupidity. I repeat, we have been too docile. We the people have been too docile for too long. We've taken our docility now for stupidity. If you don't wake up and face the reality of what we are faced with, all this that we'll do here today will just go to waste. Trust me, it's in our hands. It's not to destroy. It's to use our minds. I paint a small scenario for you to see before I leave here. The people who are in there for government, they are meant to be our servants. I repeat, they are meant to be civil servants and public servants. But what do we see now? We have see evil servants and pubic servants. I use that word, pubic servants, because it's so obscene what they do. It's so distasteful how they go about what they do. And they do it with such brigandage and arrogance that you can't say anything about it. Imagine those who call themselves policemen, soldiers, air force officers, and the paramilitary service are supposed to be our megadi. Two units, our servants and our megadi. Imagine, say, you employ house help, house boy for your house. Then your house boy come wake you up in the morning. Hey, get up. Sunday, what are you? Come cook for me. Hey, come here. Bring your wife. Then you come begin to hump your wife for your front. Hey, take that cloth. Begin to fan me. Then come here. Where your salary? Bring up. They will take your own share, come out. Give you the smoke. Come to them. Then if you want to talk, say, hey, Abdul, Ibrahim, come here. Slap him. Can that happen to you in your house? But that's what we're faced with in Nigeria. And we are the ones allowing it to happen. Think. They say, make you bring certificate. You bring 200 lawyers. And all of us keep quiet. What can be right after that? Nothing. We have to wake up and accept the fact that we are treading the wrong course. And we, the people, can change that course if we, the people, so choose collectively to be true to that which is us. Fella talked one thing some time back. He said, one will be Pekin, papa, mama be teacher. One will be for school, teacher be teacher. One will be university, lecturer be teacher. When we start to work, government be teacher. Who be government teacher? Culture and tradition. It is the culture and tradition of the Chinese. Forget the corona talk. The culture and tradition of the Indians, the Japanese, that is making them thrive and solid. Stand strong today. How well do you know your culture? How well do you know about your traditions? Those things that make you, you. We shouldn't be looking for avenues to divide ourselves. We should be looking for things to be more inclusive so that we are more productive with peace as a central theme. No right on earth should give any man in a democratic situation, the right to proclaim or act in the way those jokers are doing now. Those in the Senate and in the House, toying with our future and with our lives, we should call them to order. We should make them see reality. This is supposed to be a democratic situation, not a meritocracy. Let them know. If you throw this chance away, I beg, I'm not sure say another chance will come. It is the artists that change the course of history in every part of the world. Please, I beg of you, this day, let it mark the beginning of that true empowerment. Back for we, the people.
Guys, we're going to watch a video. This video is brought to us by Sarap. Sarap, I think they're here and they'll talk a little bit about what they do. And right before we play the video, I want to say that also one of the things that we ask is that there are so many organizations that are doing amazing things. Before you leave today, please try and connect with somebody and find a way you can help. You know what I mean? They actually are looking for ways that they can partner with people from the entertainment space to do amazing work. I know Asas does amazing work every year to raise money for malaria. You know, there are organizations that are doing that, that could help with funding, would help with structuring, and you'd give a voice to it. You know, so let's do a little bit more. I mean, after just listening to what Egbon has said, do a little bit more. Find an organization that doing something that you care about and give them your voice, give them your platform, you know. But let's listen to Sarap.
No matter where you come from for this world, now our social belief go show how we take to do things. And na law we know the book plus general behavior, na in the guide how people they see things and do things. Now these things people take they know waiting go be and the one we no go be. But most times, this general behavior, it not they bring better result. Oh. For Naija, one social behavior day, we don't spoil things for many, many years. And this behavior, not the one way people they talk say, nobody fit stop corruption, I beg. This one, na big lie. And many country people know, say na lie. Many more country people don't they sabi say, we fit commot hand for corruption. And this, na the work we all of us, no matter who you be, must put hand together and do something about. Serap do one big report to take check waiting we fit change and talk about to repair this bad behavior. And this, na some of the things where they bring come out for the report. We fit they carry gift give anybody we no gree put hand for corruption for government work. Even clap for them and praise them. See, nothing good they come out for corruption, oh, na only poverty na it they bring. Money we lost because of corruption, na everybody lost, and it they affect everybody, right? But the political mind day for Naija to fight corruption. And if you and me join hand together with better and ugly worker, better result will come out. Some go even say, nothing we fit do to stop corruption, oh. That one, na another big lie. Okay, make I tell you another one. Social media and internet, they very important for this worker. And our report shows say, now for the message, they quick spread and go far pass to reach the people. So, make all of us, whether you be government worker, banker, engineer, or teacher, even the ordinary man for street, we believe say, we fit stop corruption. Make we join hand together. Use social media and internet, take talk about them. So therefore, make the jump body where they range law for Naija, make them stop this waka where them say they won't do to bring law where go control social media. And then, make all the office where they fight corruption for Naija, make them use this social media and internet, take spread the work where them they do, give the public. We not go fit change social behavior if we not change the message and how people they think. Social media, now where we fit talk and make it loud.
Yeah. All right. Lights, please. Lights, please. Good morning, everybody. Everybody seems so sad. Egbon did his speech. Was very sobering. And this is a sobering time, but let's not be sad. Good morning, everybody. Good morning. Can we get some lights, please? I can't see the faces. Everybody's a little morose. I need to know that we're okay. And can I get the pulpit? I'm not the pastor, but I need the pulpit to put my phone down. Where is it? Okay. Thank you. Is it that you don't want people to see my face? That's all right. Thank you. Here we go. Yes, please. A little higher. Thank you. How's everybody feeling? All right. You know, they told me yesterday, Debbie told me yesterday, and yesterday was a very, very busy day, that she wanted me to speak today, so I didn't really have time to write. Wow, thank you for that. Okay. I didn't really have time to sit down and craft a speech, but it's 5-10 minutes, and I have some things that I want to share. So a lot has been said about the social media bill and about how it seeks to give our government regulatory control over conversations on social media. If you didn't know, I mean, just by spending time today, you already know what the issues are. You already know what's going to happen. You already know that, number one, it is redundant, right? Because there's already a Cyber Crimes Act that is a law that in some cases has already been abused and has already been used to lock people up. Now, this bill essentially is coming to cast that opportunity on the rest of us, on everybody who ever uses social media. This bill, if passed into law, will give the government an opportunity, possibly, but really in a place like Nigeria, probably inevitably, to use it to silence opposition, to use it to silence dissenting voices. I mean, not everybody, for instance, in our police force is bad. I'm a strong believer that we do have good police officers, but we have enough issues with the police, with SARS, with the way that power has been abused on our streets, with the numbers of young people that are maimed and beaten and locked up and taken advantage of, for us to now turn around and give them even more power on the internet so that the police becomes the judge and jury of what is deemed appropriate content online, right? So I don't want to spend too much time talking about the issues with the bill because you hear a lot of that today. Okay. You hear a lot of that today, so there's just too much danger. Now, if you didn't know this, yesterday there was a public hearing. How many people know that there was a public hearing in Abuja yesterday? Okay, to bring you up to speed, yesterday the bill had already gone through the first hearing in the Senate. It had gone through the second one, and then yesterday they gave the public a chance to come and speak about it. Now, luckily for us, over 60 people in a three-hour session took our National Assembly to task, and I think they deserve a round of applause. None of us were able to go, but a lot of amazing Nigerians went. Citizens, civil society people, people from different organizations, even people from the NCC, broadcasters, stakeholders in media, entertainment. A lot of amazing Nigerians went yesterday to take them to task. And of the over 60 people who spoke in this three-hour session, only two spoke in favor of this bill passing. There was an overwhelming majority that stood on the right side of history and said, this thing cannot be allowed to pass. So my guess, and it's a guess, and it's an estimate based on just following the news and where the conversation is in the Senate, is that this bill is probably dead, right? It's probably going to go away. But now we have a responsibility to put the nail in the coffin, okay? So we were not able to go to Abuja to be part of this public hearing. But guess what? This social media that they are trying to quiet down, it's time for us to make some noise on that same social media. And I want us to get, as a generation, I would prefer for us to get to the place where we're not waiting for an MI or a Banky or a Chigal or Lynx or Dotun only. Let each person make a video and post it. Because guess what? You know 10 people or 20 people or 50 people. Let us get to the point where a senator wakes up and they turn on their phone and they're getting hit with message, after tweet, after post, after video, not just from celebrities, but from every member of this generation that says, listen, this is my voice that you are trying to silence. We will not allow it to pass. Let's get to the place where we get some sense of personal responsibility in what is going on. Your senator's contact information is public knowledge. Your representative's contact information is public knowledge. They have an email address by law. They have emails, they have phone numbers that they have to declare so that their constituents can get a hold of them. How many of us even know who our representatives are? Talk less of taking the email and writing to them. Talk less of making a video yourself. We post about everything. Post about this. Let's get to the point where there are hundreds of thousands of young people recording videos of themselves and saying, hey, my representative is Jide Obanikoro. Honorable Jide Obanikoro, I'm a constituent in Etiosa, and I don't want you to vote in favor of this bill because it's going to come up for a third reading. Say it to your senators. Say it to your representatives. Let them feel that when they do this thing, they'll be going against the wishes of thousands of people in their constituency. Because if there's anything that they fear more than not making money, is losing their job to make that money. Okay? So the... God bless you. Thank you, Emma. So while I do feel that the bill the bill is dead and gone, I think that we've also been presented an opportunity to take this conversation a step further, right? So number one, let's all have a sense of personal responsibility. Say something, post something, do something yourself. But number two, if by God's grace this bill goes away, do we all return back to business as usual? Ladies and gentlemen, I ran for a seat in the National Assembly in this same Etiosa community. Now, I didn't win the seat, but imagine if we did. Imagine if there were like minds like this representing us in the National Assembly. Because guess what? The policies that will develop or derail our economy and our country and our democracy, that's where they are. That's why I ran to enter the National Assembly, so that at least there's a voice in there, in their private sessions, speaking on behalf of young Nigeria. So I'm going to close on this note. 2023 is coming. How many people? No. I'm not even campaigning. But I want to plant a seed in the minds of this generation. And that's what I tried to do with my campaign, because we knew going into it that it was going to be very tough to do. But we wanted to prove that certain things are even possible. Let's even know that, okay, maybe we don't have enough to overturn the presidency. Bah? The presidency is always won with 15, 16 million votes. That takes a lot of structure. It takes a lot of funding. Maybe we don't have enough to overturn gubernatorial seats. But guess what? In the National Assembly, guys, my seat in Etiosa was won with 23,000 votes. 23K. From Obalende to Lekki to VI to Ikoyi to Aja to Shangotedu. We didn't have 23,000 young people to say, listen, let's get this representative seat. So this is what I'm saying. In 2023, we have an opportunity. In 2019, how many people know that in 2019 we disrupted the political status quo a bit? We didn't win the race, but we gave them a bloody nose. We let them know that certain things are even possible. So we disrupted in 2019. In 2023, let's dethrone some people. In 2023, let's look at the country and pick 40 places that need 20,000, 25,000, 10,000 votes to become a rep. Let's get 40 like-minded people in the National Assembly. Let me tell you something. A good National Assembly can handcuff a bad president. A good National Assembly can put in policies that will work in favor of this generation. A good National Assembly. Let's put we talk about influencers. Let's put influencers in our National Assembly. It doesn't even have to be me. Okay? We just need people that are going in there, that are going to vote and put in policies that will favor us, that will put us on the road back to where we need to be as a country. And there's a personal responsibility on each and every one of us with that. INEC is going to open voter registration again at some point. As a young person, don't tell me you care about the state of the country if you won't even go and get a voter's card. Don't tell me that. And guess what? We don't need everybody. You will never have everybody in an organization. Not everybody in church is good. Not everybody in a mosque is good. Not everybody in a school, in a company, in your family. You will never get everybody. But we just need enough people. In Etiosa, we only needed 23,000. So let's take a personal responsibility. This last election, I made sure, in fact, I told my staff in EME that if you don't have your voter's card, I'm going to withhold your salary. That's how drastic and radical we need to be. So you yourself, go and get your card when they open registration. Make sure everybody in your family, everybody in your circle of influence does the same. And in 2023, we disrupted in 2019. In 2023, let's dethrone some people. Let's teach them a lesson they will never forget. Let's pay attention from now. Isn't it sad? Yesterday was International Women's Day. Bah? Do you know that the Gender Equality Bill didn't make it past the second reading? But it's the social media bill that was marching on its way to a third. Do you know that our National Assembly, at a time when so many of our young people are unemployed and uneducated, they are in favor of spending $37 billion on fixing their office building? And we are all here. They don't pass gender equality, but they want to pass social media. Do you know what else? Do you know another bill that has made it through the second reading? The bill to give themselves immunity. So there's a bill that they have proposed that says when they are in the National Assembly, you can't even prosecute them. So Senator Elisha can go and slap somebody else and you can't do anything about it. And not only can you not do anything about it, if they pass the immunity bill and they pass social media bill, you can't prosecute them. You now can't even talk. And this is who we're allowing to lead us. This is who we're allowing to set policy. It's senators. A senator married a 13-year-old, we know, in this same country. And then we talk about the rights of the child and gender-based violence and education and healthcare. Guys, we disrupted in 2019. Please, for God's sake, for goodness sake, let's dethrone some people in 2023. Let's pay attention. If you vote against gender equality, we are watching. If you vote in favor of spending money on cars and budgets and all of that, and then you leave our educational system to be what it is, we're watching you. And they need to know come 2023 that in every constituency in this country, there are enough young people to make a difference. I'm not even concerned. Let the president, people that are going to fight for president fight. What just happened in the news? It's a tale of two leaders on tape in Kano. One leader is on tape collecting thousands of dollars in bribes 15 times. 15 times allegedly collecting thousands of dollars. Another one is on tape doing what? Talking about poverty and education and healthcare and children and gender equality and the problems we're having and corruption in governance. And which one lost his job? This is the country that we have created when we sit down in silence. But I pray that those days are gone. We disrupted in 2019. In 2023, it will be time to dethrone. So please join us. God bless you. Thank you.
Thank you, Dubs, ladies and gentlemen. I don't want us to move past the action point that he spoke about lightly. Josh, too funny, just stepped in the building. Bello, I see you. Thank you, guys. Oh, my God. I don't want us to move past the action point that Banky laid out. Look, it looks like this bill is in trouble. Let's give it its death blow and let's do it tomorrow. Let's find your rep. If your number is here, we're going to send you a text with your rep, the name of your rep. Just do a video online. And just say, sir or madam, please, I don't want you to pass this bill. And then, if you wouldn't mind, ask five of your friends in entertainment to do the same thing as a challenge. If and when the bill doesn't pass, we have a success that social media can be proud of. Oh, wow, we spoke out and this thing didn't pass. And then we take it and we move on to the next thing. So tomorrow, please, and it will take seconds to do it. The other thing that Banky touched on that may, let's do it right now. Do you know what I mean? As soon as we're done, we have cameras here. We can help you record if you don't want to use your phone. But please, we'll find out who your rep is. Send them a video. Just say, you know, my name is Bello. My rep is Josh Tufoni. Please, sir, don't vote for the bill. Kill the bill challenge. I like that. I like that. Authored by Banky W. So please, how many people are going to do that? Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. No. Nicely, kindly, we're going to ask them. But the second thing I wanted to say is that one of the things that I'm gradually starting to understand and why this is important, we're trying to get them to commit to do a quarterly conference with entertainment. So hopefully I can tie his hand here. Is that there are organizations that are on this journey with us. Early this year, when Osiwa brought their partners together, I was sitting down. And there was a conversation about the middle class versus the grassroots. And then an organization, I can't remember the name on the top of my head, they came out and they said, they've went to a community and through their work and their advocacy, the community wrote to their chairman. And they said, this is the amount of money that's allocated to us. These are our priorities as a community and what we want you to do. We know how much is coming. We know what you say you want to do, but this is, and I want to take that story. I want to shoot a movie about it and spread it so that every local government can say what. So this guy is the guy that has the money, and we can actually look at the budget and see what he's going to spend, and we can tell him what. The point is that there are so many organizations. They're looking, look, the support, when I was talking to the guy in Badakor, he said, we have a fund. And that fund is available. If you guys on the proposition, if you get in trouble, we're here to support. So the second thing I want to say to us as entertainers here is look for an organization. Please do the work and look for an organization that's doing something that you care about and support them. Because as an entertainment industry, honestly, what one tweet does, I tweeted for Lawyers Alert. They told me immediately, this is the highest engagement we've had on one of our tweets. Just, hello, I'm standing here with Lawyers Alert, a little thing. And at the end of the day, we end up taking this thing. I think that's one of the things that Dede said that really stuck to me. We end up taking this power and we're using it for things that are not important. I want to bring up the mover. I'm not going to give you his official title, but the mover of an organization called Usiwa. A lot of what you saw yesterday, a lot of the stance against moving against the Civic Bill is supported by an organization called Usiwa, the Open Society in West Africa. They do an amazing work. They engaged us at Chocolate City last year, when I was at Chocolate City, to to get young people to come out and vote. To come out and vote. And they are an organization that I'm proud to be associated with. His name is Mr. Jude Elo. He spoke to us last year, and he's going to speak to us again. Please, let's put our hands together as we welcome him. Sir, give it to us hot. Give it to us hot, hot. We want to know what...
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. This stage was reserved for celebrities, and of course I'm an imposter, so please tolerate me for a few minutes and I'll be out. This is one of those days, you know, I probably will go back home and be smiling from ear to ear, being nice to everybody, like I'm walking in cloud nine. A lot of things happen in this country and we don't understand the significance. This, what you're seeing here today, has not happened before. This is the first time that people like MI, Banky, Chigo, and the rest of them will come together, bring us together, and talk to us just about our country. So it's not a concert. It's a conversation about our country. And I think it's hugely important that this industry, that our celebrities are increasingly seeing the important role they can play in changing the trajectory of this country. I'm really, really excited that this is happening, and listening to the conversation, I'm hoping this will keep happening, because we've gotten to a point where we need to tell ourselves the honest truth, that we have to fight to take our country back. Can you imagine that almost 80% of those in very important leadership positions in this country will not be around here in 30 years' time? Have you thought of that? These guys are in the departure lounges, and their decisions are going to be with you for the rest of your lives. So probably they will not be around to see the consequences of what they're doing. And as far as I'm concerned, this democracy was fought for with blood for us to get to where we are today. And I will be remiss to keep quiet. And you should also feel the same way and allow it just degenerate in front of us. Let me do a little bit of history lesson quickly. How many of us here have heard of the guy called Dele Giwa? How many of us here? In 1986, Dele Giwa was 39 years. At that age, he was the editor-in-chief of the biggest selling news magazine in Nigeria, Newswatch. He was a father of 6 children. His mother was still alive. He had a wife. Like every other young family, he had dreams. He has studied in the United States, incredibly brilliant, very purposeful, and was doing very well. I mean, he was living in a very upscale part of Ikeja then, if I remember correctly. One of his crimes was that he did a report on the forex management in Nigeria, and government didn't like that. This was at the time where you can be picked up by government, assuming they believe in their wisdom that you pose a risk to the country or you're a threat to anything. They can pick you up and keep you for almost 30, 40 days. And no court in Nigeria can entertain that matter, as long as they're doing it for the sake of national security or whatever they claim that they're doing it for. So it was at a time where every individual in Nigeria was under risk. In spite of the very draconian nature, the raids. So you come to work in some of the media houses, the police will come, raid the place, close down the office. This was how they were living. I mean, you could think this was the movie, but this was Nigeria at that time. But Delegiwa, Rebu, and the rest of them, they kept on. And Newswatch was a thorn in the flesh of government. To the point that they started doing what they call guerrilla publication. So when they go and seal off their offices, there was no internet, there was no Facebook, they couldn't do any of these things we are doing now. So when they go and seal off their offices, these guys will be printing on the go. Anybody who knows about printing will understand that that is incredibly, nearly impossible. They will print on the go. Sometimes they just print the cover of their magazine for the week, just to let people know that we are still here. And government will be chasing them. You don't know where they are printing from. You don't know who the distributors are. There was no Facebook. There was no Twitter. There was nothing. But they kept giving government heat. And someday, one day like that, somebody felt that they've had enough of Delegiwa. On a Sunday morning, he was in his family house with a reporter, their reporter in London. Just after breakfast, having a conversation, a parcel came for him. His kids were in the house. His wife was in the house. He opened this parcel, and it was a parcel bomb. It exploded, and before they could get into the hospital, he was dead. And as we speak, nobody has been arrested. Nobody has been jailed for his death. A number of these guys paid the same supreme price. The list is long. A number of them spent years in jail. Wives were arrested in place of their husbands. Kids were harassed. People had to run out of this country. Bombs were planted in vehicles. This was the kind of country we were living in. Political parties were banned. We couldn't have this conversation in those days. But they were people, they were Nigerians, young Nigerians, who were staking out their neck, going around. You heard about Radio Kudirat. Radio Kudirat was one of the biggest puzzles of the military regime. They were transmitting on the go. In fact, the radio station was transmitting from the boot of a car. This was how far they went to ensure that we have a voice as a people, to ensure that we get to where we are today. If these guys could do this under these very difficult circumstances, at the risk of losing their lives, at the risk of losing their job, at the risk of having them separated from their families, what excuse do we have in accepting the raw and hopeless deal that is handed to us in Nigeria? What excuse do we have? That we can go 1 week, we don't say anything about the environment where we live, we don't say anything about the hardship we're facing, that we have this powerful tool in our hands, capable of changing our lives, and we have not utilized it to safeguard our future. If you take a look at the 1999 Constitution, it says something that is very profound. Sovereignty rests with the citizens of Nigeria. By our constitution, the people who we have elected into office are actually our servants. They work at the pleasure of the Nigerian citizens. If there is a master-servant relationship, it is one that is skewed in the favor of citizens, not the other way around. And why the drafters of our constitution decided to make that profound statement is that democracy is built on the will of the people. What is happening now is a progressive effort by governments, by people who don't like this country, to make it impossible for me, for you, for us as a collective to exercise that sovereignty that has been given to us by our own constitution. And they do this in many simple ways. The police, they harass you on the streets. They make you feel less than human. You are a reporter, you write a story they don't like, they pick you up. You work in the judiciary, you get harassed for corruption, unnecessarily, needlessly. They remove the Chief Justice of Nigeria in a process that is manifestly unconstitutional. The governors run reckless across our states, brook no opposition. And in all of this, we just keep quiet. Now, democracies don't die from the barrel of the gun. They die from the cowardly docility of the custodians of democracy, which is you and I. And my message to you today is that you have as much stake as in this country as anyone else. Nobody has the duty of safeguarding your future for you. That duty belongs to you. And the reality is that you have the power actually to change the trend of things. For the celebrities who are here today, you have been given a unique opportunity in life, and history will not judge you kindly if you don't use that unique opportunity to make sure that we have a better country. History will not be kind to you. What you have is what a lot of people are begging and crying for. It's been gifted to you, and it will be utilized in the best interest of this country. Because right now, this country needs each and every one of us. I don't have to say it. The country is sliding. 2 days ago, the price of oil has fallen down to half of what it was. What this means is that we can't fund our budget. What this means is that probably our naira is going to collapse. We've closed our borders for months now. Inflation has hit double digits, highest ever since 2018. We are in a situation that is very dire. I don't want to talk about our education. I don't want to talk about our health. The fact that you go into a hospital, you're more worried about getting infection than getting cured. This is the reality that you live in. This is the reality that you live in. You can't keep quiet. Our life expectancy is progressively coming down. Progressively coming down. What kind of future have we given to you guys? What kind of future are you going to work with? And you have the opportunity, unique opportunity, to use the tools available to you, the knowledge that is in your hands, the network that you've been able to build, to change this trajectory. And we need to change it, not just because of ourselves. We need to change it for those who can't even speak for themselves. We need to change this for those kids who walk around the slums in Lagos without any hope of where they're going to get their next meal. We need to change it for our retired parents who can't collect their pension and who don't know where the next meal is going to come. We need to change it for the misguided young people who have taken to crime because they don't have a choice. We need to change this because it is what is human to do. The greatest service we have to society is the service we give of ourselves to society. And I call on you today to understand, if we do nothing, this country will perish. And all our dreams, all our hope, all our beauty, all our status will perish with it. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. We have a group of people that agreed to be part of the project. I want to call on a few of them to come. We'll do a little panel discussion. Really, I just have like 2 questions to ask them. And then I'll open the floor. If there's any questions or comments, that we can just have a conversation If you look around the room, you see it's mostly friends, you know, friends from media, friends from entertainment here. And we should just have a conversation. So this team, we're going to, after with all the social media activity and everything, we're also going to Abuja. And in Abuja, we're going to engage with the National Assembly, have a couple meetings with a few. I don't know if I have up to that amount of people. But okay. No, it's okay. For now, let's see. But ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together for Dotun, the energy god in the building as he comes up. When I saw her video, I was so blown away. Just the grace. She's inspired a whole generation of like young female artists with her music and everything she's done. And especially in the North. Sometimes when you're in Lagos all the time, you're not aware of the impact people are having. But if you go up North and you ask about Afro DJ, they will tell you that she's legendary. Please put your hands together for DJ in the building.
Did you say agreed?
She was saying no. But I knew she really wanted to say yes. I really want to share my thoughts. Ladies and gentlemen, another friend of ours who is always ready to just support whenever we ask. She's truly amazing, very smart. If you are ever unlucky enough to be wrong on something around her, you know, you'll be thoroughly educated. She's just a powerhouse, media powerhouse. Her name is Folu Storms. Ladies and gentlemen, let's put our hands together for Folu Storms in the building. And this last guy, I haven't even told him he's coming on stage, but I hear that later today he's going to be in Unilag interviewing people about the social media bill and getting footage and content. He is one of those guys that guys like me are not happy about that exist. You know, tall, deep voice. The only thing I'm happy about is that we are both Beard Gang, so... What happened? What happened? What happened? What were you guys say? What? I should just keep talking? I don't understand. People are always just laughing randomly around me whenever I'm talking about my beard and... Listen, in my whole village, this is the largest beard we've ever... Yeah, this is the most we've done. So celebrate with us. Ladies and gentlemen, Jeff Banks is the beauty of commas. Real quick, my first question, I'm going to ask two questions and open the floor for people to share. I think Josh has been saying that he has something he wants to say about the bill, you know. I'm so, hopefully we can take
things away.
Why are you guys agreeing to be part of this? You guys are busy. I know everybody here has thousands of things they're doing. Some of you, we had to excavate under deep inside to get to get to you. And but why? What is it about this bill that speaks to you specifically and wants you and is propelling you to be a part of this?
Okay. Good afternoon, everyone. For me, if I want to come from where I come from, if I want to come from the place I come from, I'm from Ondo State. And we are very known for speaking our minds. I can give you tons of examples. Likes of Fowl's the Bad Guy, Gani Fayemi, Femi Falana. You almost feel like we can pick integrity, education over anything. And if we're in a country where those things are not obtainable, for me, I mean, I come from a family where my dad is very outspoken. He actually made a lot of us read the news. My daddy would engage you in conversations, and you know, coming from a family where I realized that, you know, they always put other things first before money. So I mean, it's been in the, you know, sometimes we try to hide that part of us, but I think it just comes out. I almost, even in my day job, I just go in that direction. Even sometimes, sometimes with friends or everybody, I still on the field we fight over stuff. I mean, I hate to where you have to cheat people, or you have to take advantage of people, or sometimes you get into your feelings. I take him out. And I think for me, I just feel coming from a place of emotional intelligence and from empathy, I'll be honest with you, and from a dad's perspective, I mean, I have two kids, especially when they started to talk about the rape conversation. And having a connection with my girls, I realized there's a lot more that I need to do. And apart from that, for a country where you know you almost don't have the power, and this is the only thing that we have, this phone, social media, you don't know how powerful it is. So I just feel from a place of empathy, just basic common sense, we should not go through the things we're going through right now. And that's why I'm a part of this.
Hi, everyone. Hi. I think, you know, when Jude was talking at the beginning, for those people who just joined, he was asking a question about how many of us remember what it feels like to be on the streets of Lagos and to have riots happening, all this sort of stuff going on. And for me, that's why I'm speaking, because I remember that feeling. That's why I studied law, that's why I became a lawyer, that's why I became a barrister, that's why I left the law and entered media. Because there are very few things more powerful than our voice, than our ability to speak up, to talk to people when there are issues, to say, hey, that's not okay. And I saw that the reality of our country, where we are now, where we have been for a long time, if we're being honest, is that the law was not enabling people to speak up. But media was, media is. All the information we have now, whether it's people stuffing dollars in caps or clothes, whether it's women being attacked in sex shops, we know about this, whether it's people taking our money because of media. If they control that, we go right back to square one. Our children are going to also have this trauma, because it is trauma that we have all experienced. We all have collective trauma that we don't really address, we don't really talk about. We've been taught to just put our heads down, just shh. From when we're very young, intelligence is treated with hostility in this nation. So I'm speaking up because we need to say that it's not okay. We also need to say that we've been through something, but we can get out on the other side. And who's going to believe the perpetrators, the oppressors, as opposed to us? These kids that come to our windows, Oga Auntie, help me, just, you know, they don't want to be there. Do you know what it takes? Even for the police officer that stops you to ask you for 100, 90, 200, do you know what it is for a man, for any human being to come and beg you? He's begging. They don't want to do that, but we're all born into this situation, into this condition, and history will judge us for what happens at the end. Are we going to look back? At least our grandparents gave us independence to an extent. We can debate how that came about, whether it was good, whether it was bad. But we are a voice, or we're a nation that, and a generation that has more opportunity than the world has ever seen before. Stop listening to people that tell you things like this is the worst time to be alive. It's a lie. That's what oppressors say to you. Because if they tell you that and they imprison you within your mind, then you stop fighting. You stop speaking. Because as far as you're concerned, it's hopeless. Don't bother. Don't try. That is how people who are too frail and too old to really lead continue to lead, because they've convinced you that you have no power. It's an oppressive mind state. And if I, who got into this entire entertainment sphere to show people that certain things are possible, to tell our stories, whether it's film that they're going to try and censor, whether it's radio, where, you know, shout out to my radio gang, I see Smooth in the building, they send us bill, excuse you, you can't talk about this. But keep doing it, because the more you do it, the more of us that do it, they can't stop us all. So that's why I'm a part of this. That's why I'm speaking.
International Women's Day, she will tell you who goes first, okay?
How does she want it? That's why I'm doing this. good afternoon, everyone. Yes, because he reached out, that's why I came here. But not only that, it's because for the longest time, I think everyone always wants to say something. That's the truth. It's just you either have, Shana, this country you won't die for. Nobody remember anything that you're saying. You know, Nigeria is just one place that if you ask anyone, I think any other country, not that other citizens, but I feel like other people would be like, I would die for my country, blah, blah, blah. But this country doesn't really even give you a reason to die for it, because people have seen so many people ahead of us do this over and over and over again. and they don't feel like anything has changed. But the idea is you have to keep doing it until something changes. I have three kids now, so I do have more than one reason to. And one of the reasons is I also come from a place that people expect women not to say anything, or expect, or even think that women don't say anything. In the North, women are talking, women are very, very powerful. You just don't really hear about it. You start hearing about it on social media because we're reposting and posting, and different things are happening to women standing up for themselves in that area where, like they say, Enkudu won't understand, like people in Lagos won't really understand, because a lot of times people see women from the North as not fighting for themselves. But they're doing so, you're just not hearing them because the message is not passed in through the right mediums. And this is the reason why I like social media, because everybody has a medium. You don't have to go and ask somebody for one. You don't have to say, I beg, please give me 2 minutes on your radio station, Alpha. You know, all these things. You have your own IGTV. You have your own following. And the idea is to use it wisely. I didn't really understand what having a following was about. I'm not saying that I was stupid or anything. It's just... it was like, what am I even really doing that people are really following me? And so I was like, sometimes someone said, like, I don't even know how they followed me. Maybe some people have even bought for me. I don't know. You know, those kind of things. But the idea is people are following me because there's something they like about what I'm doing, what I'm saying. They're relating to something. Whether or not it's not the general, you know, relationship with music, it's something that they feel they can connect. And the idea is, instead of kind of not using the opportunity to be open about it, because I'm actually extremely shy. I feel like dying at this point. But the idea is to be able to let people know that they can do it. You do have the opportunity to talk. You do have the opportunity to change people's lives. And that's what I want to do every day, because I want my children, if the selfish thing is for my children to use it by the time they are able to, then let me do that, because other people's children will be able to use it as well. But the idea is you just can't be quiet. Being quiet doesn't really do anything. And it's not to be violent, because everyone just thinks once you start arguing about something, you want to be violent about it. I think that's the fear or something. The idea is we just want to live. Like, I just want to live. I just want to wake up, and if I don't like something, I should be able to say it. Not that they'll come to my house and come and kill me or something like that. The idea is to take out this fear that is constantly has made this cycle of just not talking. Just rid it out of my lifestyle, and just be expressive. And if they take away social media, I can't really do that, because all the other places that I would be able to go and do that is just open field and open places that people might not even come and support me. So you're in your safe environment where you can explain yourself, express yourself, and then come out and do the walk. It's not just about sitting in your couch. Or, you know. But the idea is you make them uncomfortable where you're comfortable, and then you come out and walk the walk. That's what I want to do now. I want to be able to walk the talk that I've been talking for quite some time. So, oh, everybody has a mic.
Well, Jeff, before you just talk, I want to say that Jeff is not single, ladies. Go ahead. He's in a long, committed relationship. As when his deep voice starts now, he will start. So.
Yeah, baby, I see you. Okay, so I think I'll start by speaking about us as Nigerians and our state of mind. I feel Nigeria, amongst many African countries, fought but didn't have to fight as hard as many others to gain their democracy. And so we're coming from a place of where it's like was almost handed to us. I mean, Ghana had to actually fight. There are guys that were like seriously in trouble for that. And so we take it for granted. And we've gone from that position into just accepting. So then we're now, oh, there's no light. Oh, manager now. There's no light. And they'll bring it soon. It's not foreign to us. This is how they do it. Oh, they're going to pass this bill. No wahala now. You know? It's Oyo, like, mine's nice. I don't know how yours is, but whatever it is, like, it's good. So everyone's managing, more manager. And I don't think it should be like that. And because of that, the things that upset us, the things that make our lives uncomfortable, the things that don't see a future to the generations after us, have just been let to slide. So it's appalling, to be honest. So people just find a safe haven in making jokes of everything, or or actually not having the conversation, you know? So I'm getting into this because I've realized if you ask 10, 19-year-old to 24-year-olds what this bill is about, they have no idea. But ask them what Cardi B had for dinner last night, they'll tell you, down to dessert. You know what I mean? And let's not forget, the guys who came before us, General Yakubu Gowon was ruling this country at 30 years old. 30 years old. That means he had his mind right from 21. You know what I mean? So if you're 24 and you're oblivious of the things that are you know, bigger than yourself, then we're already in the wrong direction. So I'm doing this because, you know, I've realized that people who are around my age range, you know, don't really take, no, I was talking to someone yesterday, and I was trying to get her to come on to this, and she's like, Jeff, man, me, I don't watch the news, man. I don't even know what's going on, like, this social, and I'm like, you're a heavy social media user, and you have no idea, like, what is hindering and what could affect your market. You know, that's you not knowing your business, if you ask me. You know, so I feel like this is a good thing, and I like it, and I really hope and pray that we can all put together our voices, because like Deja said, we don't realize how much power we wield at this point. You know, I'm probably one of the smallest boys in this room, but still, when I look around me, there's people who command millions of people by saying one word. You know, you can change the wave easily. And I don't think we even believe it. Like, we need to see it, we need to do it and achieve it to believe it. These guys won't believe it because it's like, oh, who are all these, you know, these, they we're serious to them. Like, they're not ready. But then as soon as it hits them now, it's like, okay, these guys, where'd they come from? You know, and we have to start it right now. I mean, there was an event, I think I told this to Emma last year, Jude last year. There was an event that was supposed to happen, a party in Europe. And the wave was to get 100 influencers to post all at the same time. And they did it. And basically, if you open your social media, say Instagram for instance, you're not seeing anything else but that. That's all you see. And the more you see something, the more your mind is fed about it. The more your curiosity is, you know, motivated. And then these 24-year-olds are going to ask like, what's this? Now it looks cool. Oh, Emma is talking about it. Chigo is talking about it. Banky is talking about it. Burner Boy is talking about it. All these guys are talking about it. What is it? So we have to come from a place of knowledge. These guys need to know what it is. We're making it cool for them, and then they jump on the train.
Yeah, I want to ask another question. Thank you, guys. And just so that... just so that we can... Because we want to open up the floor and hand the microphones out for people to talk. We're going to just sort of flow into a town hall sort of conversation. Igal is communicating to me. So yesterday I posted, or day before yesterday, 3 days ago, I posted a picture of me wearing a blue kaftan, standing in front of the Hublot sign. I was in Abuja for something. And it has almost 30,000 likes, almost 600 comments. Yesterday I posted this bill. It has 2,000 likes, 41 comments. And I bet you that at least 5 of those comments are, I'm very sorry to ask for this, but please, my 2 children are, or kindly follow.
Or I fix games.
The point is that doing this sort of work is hard work. And it's very tough. Like if you're out here trying to be popping, it's just so much harder. I know how many times people say, oh, we'll be there. You know, and if it's an event, if it's a party or something, people are going to call you to get in. If you say, hey, I'm hosting a conference about this, it's a completely different conversation. And the question I want us to ask ourselves honestly is that, look, we're all hungry. We're all coming from a place of toughness. Hey, Anna. All coming from a place of struggle. At least I am coming from a place of struggle. Is this something we should even bother getting involved in? Yeah, social media affects us. After that is done, okay, the bill is no longer passed. Should we as celebrities, as influencers, as entertainers, should we even be involved in this? Is it for the CSOs? Is it for government to figure themselves out? Because again, as I said, it's hard work to get people's attention, to get people to focus on stuff like this. Is this something we should do? Could we keep our answers to 2 minutes, within 2 minutes, so that we could...
If we want to take a cue from, our counterparts, for example, the Black Lives Matters, the reason why that thing went as far and as much as even holding the police accountable for what they've done is because a lot of people, celebrities, actually jumped on it. As a matter of fact, the conversation about rape recently is because a lot of people who are celebrities jumped on it. Even Banky's take on the election was because a lot of people jumped on it. As a matter of fact, I'll be honest, I think I almost got, I never said this to Banky, but you know, you're supposed to be non-partisan. But I took sides, exactly. I mean, even off and on. You can take sides, you understand what I'm saying, but don't let it open. But I was so passionate because knowing a guy who's smart, who's younger, who understands the system, and I didn't just do it because Banky's my friend, because I see the passion and I see the real reason why he wants to make that change. And that's why I joined in. I'm not sure I'm going to do it the next time, but I feel, because there's a lot of things that happen at the back end, because according to my ethics, I'm not supposed to. But the fact is, I just believe that we can make that change. And I'm, like I said, we're all doing the Switch Challenge by Drake, who, as a matter of fact, a lot of you guys who did that video never got posted. But the fact is, we did it anyways. So why don't we use that same energy. That's the truth. A lot of people have done the challenge now, but Drake did not even probably remember it. But like I said, this is us, this is ours. This will be good for our society, and this is good for everybody in this room, good for our future. And I see at the end of the day, if everybody speaks about the same thing all at the same time, it's not the or your case where somebody's talking and everybody's looking at it. What is he saying? But I feel like if everybody can do it all at once and join hands, it would make a lot of sense.
Should we get involved?
I mean, we should.
But I mean, after the social media bill, is this something that... it may seem like but it's tough work. If influencers are saying we want to make a change in Nigeria, it's going to be hard. We're going to have to commit. We're going to have to post and disrupt our timeline. You know what I mean? We're going to have to... Should we get involved?
We absolutely should. Listen, being in Nigeria is tough. If you want an easy life, leave. Like, leave. And even when you leave, it's not going to be easy. Like, living is tough. I think part of the problem is we're also part of a generation that expects things to be easy. But nothing in our lives have shown that life is easy. So why do we still have that in the back of our minds? The reality is, whether it's the social media bill, and I really personally am going to stop calling it that, because I think part of the reason why people are not paying attention to it is because the term social media, people associate it with being unserious, is frivolous, is just something that does it. This is access to the internet. They want to shut off the internet. That's serious, you know? And beyond that, if it's not that, it's civil rights, it's responsibilities. To me, it's these kids on the street, and I keep saying it because that's a gang generation we're raising. We're ignoring a real problem that comes to our window every day and knocks. And what they're learning from us is a lack of empathy. We don't look people in the eye who can't do anything for us. I'm talking about the guy that opens your gates, your gatesman, the handy woman in your house, whoever it is. We're not even looking at people anymore. It's me, myself, and I. Let me just focus on this. If we don't reconnect with our empathy, we're in big trouble. An experience I had the other day is I was called by an awesome filmmaker. Her handle is Fizzy the Catcher. And Fizzy's doing a documentary called No Victors. Now, she'd interviewed, and I'm talking about this because this is kind of the root also of why we're dealing with what we're dealing with as a nation. It's looking at our civil war. Now, I remember when Half the Yellow Sun was being made. In fact, I remember buying the book before it was popular, shortly after Chimamanda just won the Orange Prize. I was university in Wales and Aberystwyth. I had taken this long journey, because to go to my university was a journey. Guy, you first sit on a train for like 5 hours to Birmingham, and then 5 hours to London. And it was in that mid-stop, I entered a W.H. Smith, and I saw a place that had an African author. I didn't know this woman, didn't know, and I thought, well, I'd never really read African authors since I picked up Wole Soyinka's Prison Notes. The man died. The full quote is, man dies who stays silent in the face of tyranny. And even though I used dictionary to read Uncle Wole's book, because that guy doesn't write for us, he doesn't send us. Facts only. But it was very informative, right? It's a reminder that if you stay silent, shit is going to happen. Excuse my French, but that's the reality of life. So anyways, I bought this book, read about it, and I was horrified. And I just remember thinking, does anybody know? Do they know this happened? Like this, you know? And because my father is Yoruba, my mother was from Cross River, and she passed when I was younger. But my stepmom, Mamsi, is from Asaba. And after I came up to her, I was like, Mamsi, this whole thing. And she sits me down. She's like, I'm on a council for, we're trying to find reparations for this horrible thing. Do you even know about the Asaba massacre? And I thought, what? A whole people were massacred? And then she tells this story to me. And when I sat for this documentary that Fizzy was making, and we were all talking, and while she'd done the interview with the old soldiers, she gathered a group of young people to talk together. And she just puts it on social media. Who wants to come in and talk? And I said, let me show up. And what I saw most of all was this trauma that has been passed on from parents to their children. So we, as the children of whether it's survivors or people that only had a passing relationship with it, are carrying on these negative stereotypes of our brothers and sisters, and that is a big problem. Because it means that as we continue to go forward without addressing that division, where we say, oh, people from the north are like this, don't trust them. Oh, these people, that's how they are. Ah, those Yoruba people, they are corny. If we continue to use that in our language, even in jest, especially when your brother or your sister says, I don't like that, we'll continue to cause the problem. Because if it's not social media today, it's going to be something else tomorrow. And because on every form, whether it is government or otherwise, which personally I've stopped filling in, they're asking for your local government area. It means that we've given our oppressors the tool to segregate us and execute us if need be. That's dangerous. Who's going to stop them? Because we're all sitting there and we tick those boxes. What religion are you? It's none of your business. I'm not ticking the religion box because it has nothing to do with me getting a bank account. I'm not writing my local government area because it has nothing to do with anything. If you are asking me where I'm resident, no problem. Where I pay tax, no problem. Give that information. But as young people, we need to start saying these day-to-day things that we're ignoring, that bias that's creeped into our lives, and we're embracing it, and we're passing it on to our kids. So I have to get involved, because if it's not this, it's something else. I mean, my mouth is big. Like, I moved back to Lagos, and I learned it quick. I didn't know. I always thought I was kind of timid, because if you see me out, I'm silent. I watch people a lot. It takes a while for me to get into conversation, but I love conversation, and I love people. But I got into Lagos, and I realized it's a hostile place for me. My father had to warn me one day, said, please. Because I think I made the mistake of when someone was throwing the Bible at me excessively. I said, no problem. But you know that it's people that sat down and compiled this thing. You know there was a conference, and he said, please don't go to village and say this kind of thing. They'll beat you. And somebody bashes my car, and what I hear is, who is the man that wants this car move from here? It's always something. When we were talking about Equal Opportunities Bill, again, I stopped calling it the equality, or what's the nickname we had for it? Because people see it and they're threatened because of the way we're already raised. They'll say, it's a woman, this woman's problem, it's feminist. Oh, be careful, they're amongst us. I have cousins who joke with me like that, and I laugh. But I'm like, it's funny. But it's not funny, bro. Because it's real. It's a real, real problem. So I don't know if we want to continue being like ostriches and putting our heads in the sand. He's going to come for you. They're going to knock on your door. So we have to stand up. Let's speak up. It's ostrich behavior.
Yes,
this time. Okay, so yes, we should, definitely, less than 1 minute. I feel like we live in a generation where information has never been more free, and yet we have the most amount of ignorant people. So now it's like, okay, there's all of this freely. You can learn about anything you want, you can know about anything you want, and it's right there, but no, we don't. So we don't even know our left from our right. And I feel like that's the starting point. And this conversation is the starting point. And when we're done with this, we'll move on to the next. And we'll create such a formidable force to be reckoned with that people will ask to come in. They'll call you to come in to this conference because it'll be as big as a concert.
I mean, it's powerful. What you're saying is like every powerful nation in the world will tell you about a time when a generation of people did something. And I think the question is, what's our generation? What's the legacy of our generation, right? But what you just said is, if the young people, what did she say? Hopefully, one of the legacies of our generation is that the young people that had access to information and access to power, that they used it, and that they because what Folu touched on is that there's a generation of young people that's been left behind, and that we fought on their behalf. I don't know, DJ, if you have.
Yes, there is a generation of young people. And first of all, if people realize the power of the youth, most of our youth don't even have the phone that they can reach for this information. And I think phone services should also join in making certain things accessible to all of the country, because you will get more, even votes. People will know why they're voting. They'll understand this is a way to capture the youth. You know, we always do these challenges and campaigns, but nobody ever does the campaign to change the mindset of the youth. Feel like they don't have anything. They feel like they can't speak, nobody cares. And like she says, they're turning into, you know, different gangs that they're going to visit you later in life. You know, those kind of things. But the idea is, reach out to the youth. We're saying it, but we're not necessarily doing it. Go have stops. You know, the same way that they have public toilets on the streets of London, the same way you have a stop. How far? What's your name today? Let's talk. You know, those kind of things, because we're still in the generation where you can still meet people and talk face to face. And I think we need to first deal with that and then offer them the social media as well, or sign up, or, you know, have phone companies. Everyone is looking for what to do with artists and different people in social media influencing categories. But the idea is, nobody's saying, oh, please, you know what? Can we set up this community here? They can't really afford this kind of phone. Because if they don't even have the phones, they're not going to hear what you're saying. You know, everybody has, you know, even me, I like that phone. We know they die for 1 week, 5K, 6K, you know, all those kind of things. But the idea is, how can you make people that even have those phones get the information? These bulk SMSs that we're doing, we should pay for other kind of things, you know, raise funds for where the average youth that they go and pay 500 naira to go and do the vote that they don't know what they are voting for is who you need to reach. Because we actually right now know what we want to do, but they don't. So the reason why I want this to happen is so I can reach those people, because all this would just be of nonsense, because all it takes is 500 naira and a bag of rice or something, because everybody's hungry. So you need to feed their minds as well as, while you're doing that, so do the right thing. You know, do like, I would love to do something like a one-chop event, just come and hear what they have to say while you're eating, because we know how we connect with our youth. Do you understand? Get some suya, get some music. But the idea is, do it for the right causes. So yes, we have to get involved.
I mean, if I was this government, thank you guys. If I was this government, if you just think about it, let's say I wanted to do something like third term, for instance. And I really thought that this, you know, and this bill would be exactly what I would use, because where is the protest going to come from? It's going to come from the people that have the internet, right? The masses that don't have access to the internet that you said, what they do have is access to culture. When you release your song, it trickles down to them. And so if I can shut down the voices of the people that are talking, right, and just spread disinformation, of course, this bill makes absolute sense in that regard, and that's something we have to speak about. I want to open the floor to people here. What I'll ask is that if you're making a comment, make the comment. If you're asking a question, ask a question. And we want to be, I can see Osage over there. I also want to make sure that we are balancing. A lot of guys, I want to make sure that the ladies too, you know. So the first one I saw was over here. I think it was you. Yeah. So, I didn't see your hand, but you asked a question. But is it a question? Quick comment. All right.
First, shout out to everyone. My name is Nelson Blink. I'm a consultant trainer. Big shout out to all the panelists. I don't want to put two things you guys said together. One, with Deja saying the national unity. and you were saying national identity, right? These are two things that are very, very, very important, because the issue with Nigeria is that when we move, like if you look at my fingers now, right, if I poked her, right, as one finger, that's little impact. But if I put the five together and I punched her, she'll sleep. You see what I'm saying, right? So the problem with Nigeria is that we have too many lines of division. Like you mentioned with the Civil War, it is a painful scar that is still bleeding today, in the sense that when you go on social media and you're trying to pass your ideas, you're thinking Igbo, Yoruba, Hausa, Christian, Muslim, Buddhist, all these different things. So my comment is this, is that we need to be mindful of every single message, joke, statement you pass on social media. It is not just a joke. When you pass tribalistic jokes, it is a crack that opens wider every second. You're repeating the same mistake your parents made, your grandparents made, our great-great-grandparents made, that made them conquer us as Africans. We're dividing people. Stop dividing people. Stop joking about tribalism. Stop joking about religion. Stop joking about sex. Use social media to spread positive messages. It's easy. If it's negative, keep it in your head. If it's positive, spread it. That's all.
Thank you, Blink. I'm going to come over here to a side. Oh, no, 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 no. I've seen a little chica.
I'm sorry. Sorry, hi. I have to run away. All I want to say is, from what DJ and them have said, my thing in my head is saying to me, each one reach one, each one teach one. If each of us can reach one person, then that one person reaches another one person. Actually, I learned this because it was, I don't know whether he knew he was reiterating it during his campaign, but watching Banky go through that process, I realized if one person can reach one person, and that one person with love reaches out to another person, I think we can start to make a change. Because we are so selfish, we've become so selfish. We are concerned about me and myself. But it's a we thing. It's a we thing at the end of the day, because I really do need you to survive. I need you to survive. If we have that in our heads, and as we entreat each other, I mean the simple things of a smile, a hug, a good morning, not waking up with negative thoughts in your head. Simple things, using your social media, instead of trolling somebody early in the morning. How about say good morning, have a good day, God bless you, goodbye. If you're looking for what to say, really, at the end of the day. So if each one can reach one, and each one can teach one, I think we'll begin to be all right. Thank you very much.
I have Asagi over here.
Good afternoon, everybody. I'm very honored to be here. Emi, thank you for the invite. I want to say thank you to all the speakers and all the panelists. I have 3 points, and I'm just going to rush through it. The first is we should be aware that we are actually suffering from systemic oppression when it comes to access to information, right? So the government pulls out history from the syllabus, it means you have a group of people in their 20s and early 30s who don't know the history of the country. It's a problem. I learned about the Civil War because my mom is Igbo, and her dad was Igbo, and he taught me about the stories. That was the only way I was able to learn before I was old enough to buy books and read about the history books. So I think we're suffering from that. You have brave people who have tried to tell these stories, right? But they shut the stories down, they pulled them from the cinemas. This is passive aggression from a group of people who want to make it be that young people don't know anything about the country. If you don't know where you're coming from, you can't know where you're going towards. So I also think if we put this together, there needs to be an agenda from us as well to create a pool of information that people can actually, you know, read and access, have access to. Dija talked about it. Whether it's vast networks and you're sending text messages, right? You're collaborating with telecoms company, or you're creating a podcast, or there needs to be a pool of information that people can really understand the effects this bill will have if it is finally passed. I don't think people know the effect. We also need to start changing, you know, creating narratives. Like Folu said, if we're calling the social media bill, it's not, it doesn't carry that impact, right? But we said they're going to shut off the internet. It literally means they can do what is happening in Uganda and all these other countries, where, or in the English-speaking parts of Cameroon, where they can just shut off the internet if you guys are talking too much. You shut off the internet, it's not just the conversations. It's the guy on WhatsApp who can't sell his shoes anymore, or the person on Instagram who can't conduct their business because they shut everything down. So we have to start talking about this point and how it really affects people, you know, the everyday Nigerian, so we take it seriously. My second point is, I know we have we've charged a lot of influencers, people with hundreds of thousands of followers, right, to talk about, you know, this issue. I want to say everybody here is an influencer. If you're on social media, if you have five followers, just five, that's five people you can convince. So please, while, you know, there's a lot of conversation about what influencers can do, who's an influencer and all that, you also have an impact when you do the right thing, right? So please, let's be mindful about what we say. Like Blink said, what we say, what we do. It is so important that this tool, this thing we have in our hand, it is very, 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 very important and it's impactful. The third thing is, Doctor was talking about the media and how you sat on one side and you don't want to do it again. I want to give you credit for that. However, I even want to move a bit further and charge people in media. I worked in media for a decade. You don't need to even sit on one side. You just need to seek the truth. That's what you need to do. During the election, Banky called me, right, that something was happening in Ikoyi and that we needed to look into it and investigate it. I could have said, okay, told my guys, you know what, it's a bit dangerous. Let's just stay back. We don't want to piss anybody off. But no. I sent a reporter down, and he went down, and we covered the story, and it's on YouTube till today. You can check it. The ballot boxes didn't arrive in a local government. It didn't arrive. It didn't show up, so they didn't count it. It's wrong, and that story is out. So I think people in the media, we need to charge ourselves to seek the truth and pursue the truth. Thank you so much.
Thank you. As I go back to the side, just remember that the call for action for today is for everybody to do a little bit of research, find out the senator or the House of Reps member from your local government. Make a piece of content, whether it's a small video or a tweet, and put it out and just say, please, we don't stand for the bill and we're asking that you kill the bill. Please. I want to go over here. This second hand I saw. And then I'll go in the middle there.
Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Deji, another call from HipTV. And very quickly. The first question Emma asked the panelists is, why are you getting into this? And my question is, what does getting into this actually really does mean? I asked this because the truth is, it's easier here. We are just having a conversation. We're feeling woke and aware on Twitter and on IG. But when the push comes to shove and we are faced with an option of taking money over truth, where we are asked to take bribe, where we are asked to say, you know what, for the influence of posting a picture for my party, even if I don't care what you're doing, just take $1 million, what would we choose? I would remember that, I mean, I don't want to bring this up, but a couple of years ago, I'd never seen youth getting ready to come out and step out for a protest like the deal when Two-Face called out. But, you know, a day or two before then, you know, something happened and it didn't happen anymore. So what does getting into it really mean? I remember I was watching a video Banky did for my boss, and Banky mentioned how he realized that not only the poor people are trying to sell their votes, everybody's trying to sell their votes. So how do I know that we're not just being aware, not just being woke? What does this mean? Because the truth is, we need a leader, right? We need someone who, which is what Banky going ahead did for a lot of us. It felt like, okay, I could arrange myself right behind him, and whatever he believes in, I could keep up with that. So my question is, what does really getting into it does mean? Talking is amazing, but it would be useless if we're not doing anything about it.
I think what it really means is walking the walk. It means stop waiting for a leader. Stop waiting for a savior. In this country, we're always looking for a savior. The savior is you. It means that when it's time to speak, you speak. When it's time to walk, you walk. It means that today that I could have been at home, I have deliveries that are supposed to come in. I was like, do you know what? I have to reschedule because I said I'd come to this thing. I didn't know Jude was going to ask me to come and sit up here. I didn't. You cannot know. And this is a dangerous thing, right? And that's that's the apathy I'm talking about. What you're expressing is apathy. Where because you sit in your space, you see what has happened before, and you say to yourself, my getting involved isn't really going to do anything. That's dangerous because it's not true. You don't know the future. You don't know who's watching you that is inspired by your action. The many people that have gone before us who all stood up, who all still probably feel like today, like fella rest in peace, who probably were like, well, you know, my people are suffering and smiling. He could have sat down too because he saw. But you keep doing it because you do not know the exact impact that your speaking out and your just being is going to have on somebody else. Your style, your clothes, the ideas that you have are not uniquely yours. They are things that you have taken in from people that you respect, things that you admire, and what you see on your TV and in your radio. what we're saying is that if enough people, even without really knowing, even without really feeling it, just go through the motions, we fake it till we make it. If you just keep pushing, eventually you inspire yourself to say, do you know what? If I went out today, and tomorrow, because I'm going, and I told somebody I went out yesterday, they're like, do you know what? Shay, I've been going. Let me just go with you. That's why I'm doing it, because I don't know for sure. And you're right. All of this could come to, I can go outside, Okada would jam, even though they ban Okada. That is the end. Just say, oh, this Nigeria, I fully used to fight for Nigeria. Oh, my Shay, so sad. But personally, I'm happy with what I'm doing.
In fairness, I want to just say something about Deji. Deji is an exceptional young man. He invited me to speak to a bunch of young people in Abuja, and he is walking the walk. And I think that I will say to you that what Folu just said first to you is that you are that leader that we are all waiting for. So continue doing what you're doing. Continue asking these questions. You know what I mean? I know that people don't know him. I know people don't know him, but I want to say that he is somebody that has been walking the walk from Abuja to Lagos. You know, go ahead.
Emma, people know I attack people who say, are very dependent on celebrities to pass information. I'm very outspoken about things like that. I don't understand, and I'll be honest, there's this idea of public figure. I don't understand it. It feels like it's a tag. And in Nigeria, this is the way we play it out. You're a public figure, they feel, oh, because you're a public figure, you should not speak your mind or just be in a certain way. I mean, DJ, I'll be honest with you, everybody started from somewhere. I hate the idea of you saying, oh, someone is a commoner, or because you're a celebrity, then you have, yes, you have a lot of power. But for everybody who fought for something for Nigeria, started from somewhere. You see, it doesn't have to be with a tag, or you're a celebrity, or you have a status or anything. Everybody would have, you have numbers. See, you are a celebrity in your family. The fact that you feed 5 people, You are the top guy. You're almost like the guy that when it comes to community meetings, you're the first to speak because you're the one who takes care of everybody. Even if you have 5 followers, you have 2, you have 3, use your platform. Nobody is a commoner. Nobody is a king. Nobody is a queen. Yes, it's a tag, but you can also be a king in your community. Start from somewhere.
Right before we pass to Banky. Banky's saying something. I know he has to leave. I also want to say something that we're not really doing a good job about talking our successes, right? So Banky W ran for office. Banky W ran for office in probably the hardest seat, top 10 hardest seats to get in the country, on a seat that had been promised already. This maybe let us say fake news. I feel that this seat, so that they don't. But here's the point. Here we have Folu, we have Dotun. I remember that when the Dakolos came out with their story, I remember that Dotun went crazy on his Instagram. And he was just talking and using his platform. The truth about it is that when we sometimes don't pat ourselves on the back enough, but something has started. And I guess that when we come here, we should remind ourselves that, look, every day we're taking steps. Every day we're moving forward. And that there's something, Banky, I know you want to share something for you.
Then we have someone. Just want to, because I really like the question that you asked, and I just wanted to kind of echo some of the sentiments that have been said. I think one of my favorite things now is when people discuss action. Because we've talked a lot, right? I can't tell you how many of these kinds of sessions I've spoken at, sat in, participated in over the years. But even when we started discussing all the things that we did, the first thing I said in the meeting is, we have to get to the point to what are the concrete action points that we're going to do? Now, I think what's very important is that everybody here lives with a couple of action points that you are going to at least do those things. One is you're going to speak publicly to your senator or your representative or both of them in a video on your social media. Whether you have 1 follower or 10 or 5 million, it doesn't matter. Do that. That's one action point. The second action point is when they open voter registration, register to vote. We have discussed this thing. The problem in Nigeria, I've said this a million times, the problem in Nigeria is from the top down. The solution is from the bottom. your representative in your local constituency probably won that seat with anywhere between 10 and 30,000 votes. There are enough of you there. You just need to gather those numbers together. So make a personal commitment to yourself. If you didn't vote last time, it's fine. But register for the next go around. Third action point, and this is something that we're applying at the Banky Wellington organization and something that MI has mentioned a few times today. Guys, greatness, the greatness that you are seeking to achieve in life, in this life, is more than what you get. It's also about what you give. So find somewhere, some organization, some community to give. Do something that is greater than your own personal pursuit of success. Let me give you an example. Thank you. You can, you'll be the only person to clap. Do something that is greater than, yes, chase for success, chase for wealth, chase for relevance and all of that. But do something that is bigger than you. And what do I mean? I go to a church called the Waterbrook. At the Waterbrook and at the Banky Wellington Foundation, we have committed that every last Saturday of the month, we're going to do community service. Even if it's as simple as 20, 30 people get together and we pick up trash on our streets. Do you know that we all, so many of us have had the opportunity to travel outside of the country, and something as simple as how clean the streets are. But we come back to Lagos, and where we live and work and play, you are driving on Providence Street. We came to Providence Street last Saturday in February to just pick up the trash. Because you know what? It has to be more than just making sure my house is nice now. It has to be more than making sure I have money in my bank account. Commit to something. If you don't have anything to come to, come and join us every last Saturday of the month. This March, we're going to do a clothing and food drive. If you don't know and you don't know what to do, you don't have anything to do, DM. We just opened our Instagram, the BW org on Instagram. Send us a DM. Bring clothes. All my celebrities in the house, that's the one thing that you have too much of, is clothes and shoes. Bring it. Let's even just give clothes to the... Folu said something that's very powerful. Where is our empathy? Where is our care? Where is our concern? Let's even get back to the basics, yeah? Number one, speak to your representative. Number two, register to vote. Number three, serve your community. There's a quote by Mark Twain that I've always kept in my heart. It says, patriotism is loyalty to your country all the time, and loyalty to your government when it deserves it. Keep that in your mind. Be loyal to Nigeria. Play a part in the Nigeria you want to see. Pick up the trash. Give away clothes and food. Serve your community somewhere. If you don't know where to serve, come and serve with me. We are going to be there every month. But I think that in the very least, we've given you three things today that are directly within your control. Start there and see what happens. And this country will be better by God's grace.
I think we'll do one more comment.
Sorry, just okay, to find your reps, go to www.nass, so like National Assembly, NASSNIG.org. No, .org. That's why it's not .com, it's .org. Also shineyoureye.org, but if you find your legislator, you'll see the legislator tab, click on it. You can search literally Lagos, it'll come up. You'll see your constituency reps on
there. Where's Toda?
Okay, NASSNIG.org. I did that while I was waiting for this to start. I sent an email. Abanikoro is mine as well. So Ibrahim is going to receive a lot of emails and text messages. Their information is up there. So NASSNIG.org.
If you also see this young lady, she has a camera crew outside that they can make the content for you, right? So just, it will take a few seconds to find your rep. They'll film it, they'll edit it, they'll get it back to you, and we'll also put it up on our page and stuff. So just look for Toda before you leave if you don't want to make it by yourself. Do you know what I mean? Thank you, Toda. Yes, go ahead.
All right, my name is Samuel, and what I want to talk about now is the conversation we've been having is around the youths, the young people, and to be honest, it's going to take a lot of time and it's hard. But there is also a conversation that we've not really talked about, and that's the children, the people who are growing up. I just saw a movie recently, and the way Hitler made Germany hate the Jews was by educating the children that the Jews were devilish, were demonic. And so they grew up with that notion that the Jews were destructive and they hated them from scratch. So if we can start having conversations around educating children, those in primary schools, nursery schools, secondary schools, about these things so that by the time they become youths, they are strong already. Thank you.
I mean, just to put it in context, I think maybe that's the last comment we'll take for now. We'll end up, it will end in food and cocktails, by the way, guys. So stick around. But I want to put in context what you said. The guy that was dethroned yesterday. Now, if you understand the North very well, you're going to understand that there are some walls that an ordinary citizen like you and I can't cross in when we talk about education. There are some guidelines within which you can talk about education. You can talk about women's rights in the North. And here you have a guy who, against the grain, historically against the grain, has called them to accountability on those three things: education, the girls' rights, and development in the North. These three things. And yesterday, somebody who is on record, allegedly on record for corruption, dethroned him yesterday. So we're dealing with layers. And that's the reason why this bill, as it stands, that piece of content that you put up today, that little piece of content that is going to add to this nationwide push to tell this bill, is the step one in letting the government know we're paying attention and we're not going to allow you push back. And the reason why that's important is because key issues at that level, they are problems of scale that really the government is the one that can solve that problem. You and I can't build the schools. We will not even get the permits. Even if we had the money, we would not even get the permits. And when we build the schools, they were going to ask us questions. Where are you from? What's your religion? Why are you doing this? What do you want to teach the kids? We would be locked up in bureaucracy for years. That's why their leaders must be held accountable. So when somebody says, we are doing a bad job and not enough young girls are in school, we shouldn't be allowed to marry young, and then they say, okay, we're going to move you out of office, then we should be really scared. We should be really, really, really scared. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you guys so much. Yeah, the hashtag for today is hashtag leave our social media alone. You can also use hashtag kill the bill. Last two things. Again, as I said, it ends in cocktails and food. Thank you, Beverly. I see you coming. There are people that I asked to come through last minute. If I haven't, hailed you, I beg, no vex. Black Bones is in the building. Black Bones has the funniest videos. Do one for us. The Oga Dele song is in the building. Legend, media powerhouse. Thank you so much for coming, sir. We're going to hear from one or two organizations. Now, the reason why this is important, remember we said there are organizations that have been doing this work and are looking for people to get involved. My journey with CSO started with the EIE. That's Enough is Enough. We all know about the Enough is Enough movement and how they started. But we have Adeoluwa here, and he's going to talk to us a little bit about the Enough is Enough movement. They're celebrating 10 years, are they? 10 years. All right. Thank you. Let's put our hands together for him.
Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Adeoluwa, like Judas mentioned. And so they'll play two videos, I think. I'm not sure what they're doing. We played two videos. I'll run through a couple of images, just talking through our journey, the work we've done, and trying to put it in the context of what the conversation we just had, and then what you can do. I know I'm particularly to Deji's point about the fact that what can we do? How does all of this talk turn into action?
If you haven't done the do, please go and do the do so we can all do the do together and do it. Do. Get your PVC big. Hello. Don't be. West. That's it. Bye bye.
easy.
Yes, yeah, go. Finally on the PVC. Sorry, it's upside down. Finally on my PVC. If you haven't done the do, please go and do the do so we can all do the do together and do it. Do. Get your PVC, dick. Hello, don't be a waste.
In the next few minutes on something I call the power of a single voice. Next slide, please. Hello, guys. Help me here. So in 2010, well, I believe it's like images would come, but they're just images. In 2010, for those of us who are raised quite conversant with Nigeria's history, Yaradua was missing. I don't know how many people are quite conversant with that conversation. In December 2009, he had left for Saudi Arabia. Blah, blah, blah. Basically, we didn't have a president, and technically, he didn't hand over power to his vice president, who was Goodluck Jonathan. And January of that year, Wole Soyinka and Tunde Bakare marched on the streets of Abuja and saying, what's happening, blah, blah, blah. Well, we should have a president, this should happen. And a gentleman called Jude Judonwo in February, a week after that protest, sent out an email called, "Where's the outrage?" And in sending out that email, a single email to a couple of friends, led to this. Next slide, please. Let's lend to this protest on March 16, which will be 10 years next Monday. And by that single email, and remember, I'm talking about the power of a single voice. A single email to the Judo was said, called the "Where's the Outrage?" led to all of these young people. I think Daily Momodu, Bob D, Omotal. Next slide. Led to Aidu Maikori being harassed by the police. And it just talks about what could happen when you use your single voice. And of course, this protest led to the organization I work with, been working with it for the past 3 years, 6 months now, called Enough is Enough Nigeria. And the work we're doing in Enough Nigeria, as from the time we began, went somewhere around protests, particularly within our first 5 years. Next slide. So to Occupy Nigeria. Next slide. To shouting at the National Assembly that money they collected too much was in 2014, in 2013. Next one. And then bring back our girls that we are familiar with. Next. But there's something we call the office of the citizen, and that's what the conversation we started in 2015 at our fifth anniversary. And it's basically the fact that the highest office in the land is the office of the citizen. And Dede had spoken about it, the concept of the office of the citizen and the concept of democracy, and how he works earlier when he spoke. And I think the very most important thing that we all need to understand, and particularly in walking the talk and the things we've said all today, is that the power lies in your hand. And simply the way the office of citizen works and the way democracy works, and we all need to understand, is as though myself and all of us in this room own a company. But we are too free, we are too fly, and we do not want to see it in that company. So sake of, for example, we own GT Bank, Guarantee Trust Bank. And we all feel fly, and we do not want to run the management of Guarantee Trust Bank. And then we say, hypothesis, fiction. Shegun Agbaje, we want you to run Guarantee Trust Bank for us. It's our bank. And then we say, Shegun Agbaje, we want you to run Guarantee Trust Bank for us. And then Shegun Agbaje runs Guarantee Trust Bank for us. And then at the end of the year, we call to Shegun Agbaje and we say, so what profit did Guarantee Trust Bank make this year? And then he says, well, I don't know and I do not report to you. He couldn't say that because the company belongs to us. And that's exactly how democracy works. That's exactly the concept of democracy and the reason why we say the office of the citizen is the highest office in the land. It's because the country belongs to all of us, but not all of us wants to run the country. It's practically impossible for all 180 million Nigerians to run the country, to direct the affairs of the country. And it's why we believe and we stand and continue. Next slide, please. Well, I stand and continue to say that the office of the citizen is the highest office. Can you play this video if you can? And hopefully it has sound. Hello guys, it's a video, can we play it? I just move on. If it doesn't have sound, let's just skip. is where it gets interesting for us. I mean, people remember this image, February 7, Eco-Atlantic. And it's where it gets interesting for us, particularly with the work we do in EIA and the Office of the Citizen. For all of us, this was Occupy Lagos. Now, some people will call that protest a failure, but for us, it was a win. And it's a win in the sense that, one, it was a young lady who came up on Twitter and basically said, it makes no sense for the governor of Lagos to wake up 5 days to the beginning of a new month and ban Okada and Kekes in Lagos. And hence, I'm calling on young professionals like myself to protest against the ban of Keke and Okada. Now, what used to happen in the past, and I think this kind of things has happened, is that normally it's individual organizations like EIA Nigeria that would reach out to influencers, tier one influencers like MI, Banky, and says, guys, come, let's go to the streets and protest. Normally, it would be maybe a tuba bar that could call for a protest and say, let's go protest this thing. Or it could be just anybody that does this. But where it became interesting for us and where we believe the power lies is that the conversations need to move from organizations like Enough is Enough Nigeria to people sitting in this room taking action. Now, should it be protests? Maybe. Should it be calling your senators? Maybe. But whatever action needs to happen needs to move beyond CSOs. I mean, I've been quite addicted to Twitter. I'm reducing that these days. But in my good days on Twitter, I mean, you see all kind of Twitter streets. And, you know, they call it politics Twitter. And it's left for some set of people to do. But like the example I used about we ourselves and handing over the Guarantee Trust Bank to Segun Agbaje, you cannot allow to leave this country to politics Twitter. You cannot allow to leave, and also because the decisions they make and the things they do affect us as people. They affect your lives. We've left it to the politicians, we've left it to the people that are politically inclined that brought a bill like the social media bill, like we call it today. And then next slide. Hello guys, next slide. And for me, this is the most powerful part of it all. And this is where exactly the problem lies. We do not know our true power. Now, if you look at this slide, you'll find out that there are a mass set of people here, and there's one politician here. And then everybody is just onlooking, just looking at him. But what happens when every single person starts to take their steps and leave? The old power that he has is all based on because people, everybody just sit and they're just standing and folding their hands and looking at him. What begins to happen when we all leave and take actions? And the most interesting part of this, and why I like this, is because, yes, there are tier one influencers in the room. But if there are 100 people in this room, there are only about 10 tier one influencers. So if the 10 tier one influencers decide to do nothing, and the remaining 90 people leave, they're all falling down. So don't wait for the tier one influencers. Do something. Next slide, please. Not every time rant, sometimes act. Not every time rant. Ranting is good. I can tell you, it's good. The retweets are good. The retweets are threatening them. They are afraid. If they are not afraid, they will not they will not plan to shut down social media. But sometimes act, and the time for action is now. And for us at AIE, we see everybody as a thumb. And the concept of a thumb is, the thumb is the only finger that can reach all of every other four fingers. And if you see yourself as a thumb, that by being a thumb, you pick up and you reach your forefinger, your middle finger, your ring finger, and your index finger, change begins to happen. So if everybody starts to see themselves as a thumb, and you're not just ranting, you're not just going to your WhatsApp sources, your Instagram stories, your Twitter page, but you're actually doing something and you're making change happen in the little way you can with your two followers. You speak a message to them, it happens. Next slide, what can you do today? Call your senator. And it's very simple why you should call your senator. I just say to you that if all 109 senators, maybe not 109, I think some offices are empty, all over 100 senators in Nigeria wake up tomorrow morning and 500 messages, just 500 messages on their phone saying cancel social media bill, the country is going to be in turmoil. I'm just saying, just 500 messages, just 500 messages, or 500 messages, phone calls. Not even social media this time around. SMS is 4 naira. Everybody picks up their phone and you send an SMS to your senator, whoever your senator is. We're in Lagos East. Senator is the gentleman called Pepe. I can't remember. Bayosom something is his name. Send an SMS to him and say, hey, cancel social media bill. Everybody in this room picks up their phone and sends an SMS to him. The guy is going to be afraid. And then he picks the senator and calls the lady in the Lagos Central, and says, I received 100 messages, oh, my man, what's happening? And she says, I received 200 messages. And then they call the guy at the other end of Lagos, Yayi Solomadiola, and says, oh, I also received 400 messages. The Lagos caucus is in trouble. I can tell you for a fact that there's going to be a meeting in Bodilon with just a few hundred messages. And that's the power you hold. And it goes back to the slide that I just shown. And so what's my charge for us today? The next slide. You can't mute the voice of freedom. And why can't you mute the voice of freedom? Because people would continue to speak. And as long as bills like the one we have in the house today are in the house, it tells you that you are powerful. Because if you are not powerful, you will not be told to keep quiet. If you are not powerful, you will not be told to keep quiet. So please keep ranting, but also take action. Now, my friend, I'll play. Quite painfully, the videos didn't play. Emma is a very huge friend of the house. We tend to harass him a lot. And he also confers and helps us out. We're going to be reaching out to you. We're going to be asking you to help us. We're going to be asking you at one point or the other to help us in our campaigns and this. And the reason is very simple. There are two sets of people that influence the culture of a society, the religious leaders and the celebrators. And of course, while we do a bit of work with religious leaders also, we also, and which is why I would have loved those videos to play. The earlier videos were videos from the year 2010, when we started this journey. And we'll be reaching out to you and we'd like you to also please, we understand that you're busy people, we understand that you would like to make an income, but please, these are very important messages and there are people that look out to you. And as we come to you, please respond. Kindly engage us. Sometimes we are not going to ask of too much. Sometimes it could just be a 59 seconds video on your Instagram. Sometimes it's just a single tweet on your Twitter page. But as much as you are doing it, and remember what I said about the power of a thumb. The thumb is the only finger that can reach all four fingers. And as we reach out to you, we come to you and say, oh, help us with this, help us with that. Please do reach out to us, respond to us, and we are happy. So guys, know that the voice of freedom can be muted. Thank you.
Yeah, real quick, we're also going to hear from Joke. Joke is part of Serap. Serap are doing amazing work. Okay, yeah. Sorry, I forgot about that. Where's the podium? Okay, there we go. Yeah. You want to be on the stage or? Yeah, okay.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Joke Fekumo, and I work with Serap. I bring greetings from Serap, and at Serap we say we're proud with this. And we say that it's a great time to be part of this conference at a time like this, when the media space in Nigeria is gagged, when the freedom of expression is suppressed in Nigeria, and the height of it is the social media bill. Unfortunately, the social media bill and the current attacks on media practitioners in Nigeria is a draconian violation of Section 39 of the 1999 Constitution. Serap is non-partisan, is a non-governmental organization, and we do a lot of work via the freedom of expression and the press that we have. I think it was Banky W that was talking about immunity for lawmakers recently. Some of us didn't hear about it, and we don't even know about it. But immediately we heard about it that the lawmakers are trying to alter Section 308 of the Constitution to include immunity for lawmakers. We advocated against it. Some of our works have had to do with abolishing double emoluments for people who are in office right now, say people who have served as governors before and who are now ministers and senators and are earning pensions of hundreds of millions of naira every year and are earning salaries in their present offices. So Serap has advocated against double emolument, have advocated against corruption, against violation of the rights of people, against decaying infrastructure, education, health, and what have you. Now, in pursuance of our job of promoting freedom of expression, some of our works include the following. Like, I was told that we're going to be sharing some of our stories at Serap. So with regards to freedom of expression, basically, some of our works include the following. In the year 1999, Serap and other CSOs condemned the arrest and detention of political activist and social media influencer Deji Adeyanju by the Nigerian police force for leading a protest against partisan conduct of top security chiefs ahead of Nigeria's general elections in February 2019. Then, we also attacked. We also condemned attacks and arrests on journalists covering the Revolution Now protest. I don't know whether we remember Revolution Now protest last year. Yes, Serap condemned the arrest and attacks on journalists covering the Revolution Now protest. And we did that through our social media platform. We believe the rights of journalists to cover and report issues and happenings in the society is guaranteed under the Constitution of Nigeria. It would also interest you that last year when Shore was detained, the height of our advocacy against that detention was for us to write to the Archbishop of Canterbury, Justin Welby, to prevail on President Buhari to please release our own Shore. Yes, we have organized several sessions and trainings for journalists on how to deploy the Freedom of Information Act in requesting for information in Nigeria. Also, last year, we urged the Nigerian army to vacate the offices of Daily Trust newspaper and release their journalists who were arrested in Abuja and Maiduguri on the allegation of releasing unfounded military information to Boko Haram insurgents. Over time, we have canvassed for the release of journalists such as Samuel Ogundipe of Premium Times, Mary Ekere in Akwa Ibom State, Evelyn Okaku of Premium Times, Dapo Olorunyomi, Deji Adeyanju. Then, recently, we condemned the arrest of Mr. Ibrahim Dan Halilu, a journalist who was arrested and detained by the Department of State Services through the hashtag journalism is not a crime. And we engaged Nigerians to demand the release of the journalist. Also, in 2019, upon the introduction of the social media bill or the reintroduction, we began fearless advocacy against the obnoxious bill. And it will interest you that last week Friday, we sent a memorandum to the Senate on the social media bill. And yesterday, Serap was physically present at the National Assembly where the public hearing on the social media bill took place. Thank you, thank you, thank you. At first, our representative was not allowed to enter into the Senate Hall, into the building. He and some other CSO representatives, but at a point, they allowed them to enter, and he made his recommendation. And at Serap, we specifically recommended that the proposed social media bill be immediately dropped, as it does not fit into the ideals of a democratic society built on the foundations of the rule of law. Conclusively, at Serap, we need your collaboration and your partnership. And we state that if the social media bill is eventually passed into law, our works and advocacy on freedom of expression, particularly online media advocacy, will be stifled, and this will mean citizens will be thrown into jail at the behest of non-conforming politicians. Freedom of expression will be suppressed at will, as there will be no voice to speak on the behalf of these people, and ultimately to lead Nigeria to a state of chaos and catastrophe. Thank you for your rapt attention.
Sir Rap just did an amazing research project on corruption. And hopefully we're trying to work with them on that. So say we'll come and talk to you about it. Because they're talking about the everyday things that we take for granted that end up incubating corruption. You know, every time we give a policeman or, you know. But stay tuned, guys. We're going to reach out to you guys about that. Last but definitely not least, Connected Development are in the building. Busayo is here to share with us. And let's put our hands together for Busayo.
Thank you. We have a video that is going to play. I'll just hopefully. Okay. There's no audio.
Connected Development tries to empower marginalized communities with access to information. We do this by creating platforms for informed debate between government and communities at the grassroots, while leveraging on Follow the Money platform. Follow the Money tries to answer where funds are coming from, where they're going to, but most importantly, how judiciously these funds are being used to impact grassroots communities.
Our focus is to influence government policies and practices that will bring about socioeconomic development in the country.
Follow the Money ensures that when government funds are budgeted, released, we track these funds to ensure that communities have access to clean and potable drinking water. Today in Nigeria, we have over 10 million out of school children. Millions of dollars and billions of naira have been budgeted and released for basic education. Follow the Money ensures that this money, when released, found their ways to grassroots communities to ensure infrastructures are provided and teaching aid are provided for teachers and pupils in school.
Through our social accountability initiative, we are addressing deep governance challenges on transparency, accountability, and citizens' engagement.
We've had quite a number of impacts. In 2018 alone, we were able to track over $10 million and impacted directly 2 million lives in over 70 grassroots rural communities. Using technology tools to document voices and amplify them on social media, today, Follow the Money is the largest social accountability platform.
What is our message? The voice counts. You have the right to demand improved public service from your elected representatives. You deserve better healthcare service. You deserve access to safe and clean water. Your children deserve a right to education.
Irrespective of where you are around the world, your voice can ensure that public resources work for public good.
Yep, thank you very much. Can I have my slides now? So I work with Follow the Money. I work for Follow the Money. Connected Development is the organization. And we're also founded by Osiwa. Please, can you put your hands together for Mr. Jude? Thank you. Thank you so much. Yeah, the work we do is quite important because we try to answer the question of where money comes from, where it goes to, what it does, where it goes to. Now, currently in Nigeria, we say we have 13.2 million out of school children. Some government guys will say we have 10.5 million out of school children in the country. But no matter the data you choose to go with, we have a situation in our hands where we have a whole lot of children out of school, and it's quite alarming. Now, look into the next 20 years of those children who have not gone to school. We'd have Boko Haram times 200 or times 2 million, or we have Boko Haram times 10 million. It's really scary. Now, I've had the opportunity to work in the Northeast. I've slept on the road between Maiduguri and Yobe. I don't know precisely where over 30 people were killed sometimes last month. Now, what happens is the military blocks the gates and they go to sleep. And we citizens are left stranded in doing our job, in amplifying the voices of people in local communities. I would not stick to my slide. I'll just talk from my heart, but it's very important. Now, what we do is just basically document the voices of citizens with our smartphones everywhere we go to. And we come back on Twitter and share the story of what is happening in these rural communities. And for us, it's one of the greatest things that has happened to us. I'm talking about technology. Use of technology. So that some of us cannot put ourselves or will not put ourselves in so much harm when we don't have to get into the places where we work physically. Now, what happens when social media bill scales through is the fact that I cannot be able to come and tell that government has budgeted XYZ amount of money to construct a school and the school is not constructed, or a healthcare that is supposed to be free, efficient, you go there, you get drugs, do not have drugs. And for us, it's really going to be a big deal to continue the work we do. I remember vividly on the 8th of June 1998, yes, I was in primary school and I was coming back from school. And people were jubilating on the street and they said, someone died. I really didn't care about governance at that point. I was a baby. And we discovered that there was an end to the military rule we had then. And we currently have a civil rule, or we had a civil rule from 1999 to this time we're currently speaking. You know, but it's saddening that today I can have a similitude of the experiences that happened in the military time, you know, even in the democratic situation we have, which doesn't make too much sense, because the kind of work I do is a work where I have to call a spade, I have to say, hey, XYZ governor, you've gotten XYZ amount of money to do XYZ job. If you're not doing that job, please, where is the money? Now, we use various tools. EIE uses the tool. SERAP uses the tool. We use the FY, the Freedom of Information Law. Now, as a private citizen, you can pick up your pen or pick up your computer and type a letter to any government agency in the country apart from the military establishment and ask them for information about what is happening in your own community, the projects they are about to do, anything government is doing at all. You have the right as a private citizen. Now, what happens when we don't use those rights we have is currently what we currently have today, where a government will wake up or some few people will wake up and want to regulate the social media, where we can even share this information we get when government is not doing the work government is supposed to be doing. Now, I'm saying this on the strength of the fact that if we all begin to talk, I know we've said that today, if we all begin to talk, if we all begin to say the right things to the people in the places where they are supposed to be said to them, we may probably get a change, a shift in the society or a shift in the system. I am going to finally end up with this thought. I don't know, Kamara, can we have this in the room? Now, this is a petition saying that the government, EFCC, ICPC, and every other government agency responsible for the regulation of the oil and gas sector, you know, should wake up to their responsibilities to be able to prosecute those people who are doing business in Nigeria without following the due processes. I'm talking about those people who move oil from this country without paying taxes. I'm talking about those companies who shouldn't even do business in Nigeria because they are not registered and they are doing businesses in Nigeria and nothing is happening to them. Now, please just take up this form, probably outside, and sign this petition. You can cut it off. You can cut it off when you get it. You can cut it off. I just need you to sign this petition with your name. Tear it off. You have this to yourself. You can probably read through and see what it's talking about. Now, lastly, before I drop this mic, please, I want to beg all of us seated in this room. This is the best time to act in favor of Nigeria. This is the best time to act in favor of our children yet unborn. I don't want to say the same stories to my children about how I came into a country or how I was born into a country circumstantially and things were not working and I didn't do anything. Connected Development will continue to do its part. MI is doing its part. Judy is doing its part. EIE is doing their part. SERAP is doing their part. But much more than everything we're doing as collective, as a group, every individual must take it upon themselves as a responsibility to ensure that Nigeria works. And I probably believe that Nigeria will work in my time so that my children would live a better life. Thank you very much.
Yeah. I mean, one of the things I want us to think about, especially as entertainers, is, oh, wow. Am I safe? Is getting a job. And what I mean by that is find an organization. Like we just heard Connected Development. We heard SERAP. Go up to them. Say, hey, I want to work. I want to use my platform and my voice and my ideas and be a part of it. It adds to your income. It adds a little bit. But with the insight that you have, you do a lot more. We have an amazing performer here, and then there's going to be food, there's going to be drinks. We're going to sit down and talk and just shake hands and meet someone. Thank you, guys, everybody that stayed here. I also want to give a special mention. Many, many years ago, this was in Abuja, I was performing somewhere, and this time, you can't just get to see, even up to now, you can't get to see KK and D1 straight. And so I went and met... He came and met me, actually. I performed, and he came and met me. This is way before MI was MI. His name is Dele Esson. He's here. And while I was sitting next to him, he has gone online. He has found the information about his House of Rep member. He has taken the person's number, and he has sent them a message on WhatsApp. Right here, he just showed me. It's amazing. Let's remember our call to action. Everybody, please, look for the site. Find your rep. Post a video online or something on social media that we can use the hashtags and tag. And ladies and gentlemen, right before we close, we have an amazing performance. She's a superstar. She's one of the baddest voices in the industry, one of the best performers. She's truly amazing. She's going to serenade us tonight, this afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Her name is Banker. Please put your hands together for the one, the only Banker.
To express myself through singing.
Simply amazing. Ladies and gentlemen, just in closing, we want to say, first of all, a big thank you to all the CSOs that are here. We want to thank them not for coming here, but every day in silence and quiet, they work hard on our behalf. They are the last line of defense that we have. So for Connected Development, for EIE, and for SERAP, thank you guys for the work that you do every day. For Osiwa, our fearless leader, Jude Elo and his team, they are just amazing. From the first time that I had a meeting with them, they've always been supportive. But not just that, they've helped us to rethink what our impact will be as we reflect on the words that Banke just left us with. When Kobe Bryant passed away 2 weeks ago, or 3 weeks ago, Abby? It's like 3 weeks ago? It's a month ago? I think that there are two legacies that he left for me. Number one was he was so proud of being a girl dad and that he had publicly told everyone that his daughter was enough to carry his legacy every time people told him. And when you think about the journey towards equality and female rights, you think about the fact that here's somebody who started out his journey, you know, he had some trouble early on in his life, but made it a point to continue to do what he could. He was training an all-female basketball team, spending most of his time there. And the second thing is just his legacy towards work. The question is, because we know for a fact that we're all going to die, the question is, when you die, what are people going to say about you? You know. And at the end of the day, this is an opportunity for us to reflect on that and think about that with our voices, with our platforms. What are they going to remember about us? Are we going to be the generation that stood for change and fought for something different? Are we going to be the people that said to the government, you shall not pass, and this bill shall not pass? Are we going to be the people that said we will post but didn't post? because I'll be there at your burial if you die before me, and I'll say, he was a nice guy, but in 2020, he said he would post, and he didn't post. Thank you. They asked me to tell you guys, please don't leave without eating. Please don't leave without eating. Thank you guys so much for coming. God bless you. Enjoy the rest of your day. Thank you to the task team also, Toda, Debbie, Kamara, and everybody that's part of, you know, Omis, Isosa, who am I? Paul, everyone. Thank you guys for coming out. God bless you. Please grab something to eat. Grab something to drink before you leave. Thank you to Kairos Hub. And yes, enjoy the rest of your day.
I'm a citizen of Nigeria. I live and work in Nigeria. I believe in an open, transparent, and accountable government. I be how you see them.
Yes, your girl, finally on the PVC. Sorry, it's upside down. Finally on my PVC. If you haven't done the do, please go and do the do so we can all do the do together and do it. Do. Get your PVC, big. Hello, don't be a waste. That's it. Mwaba. PVC is the way. Yes, your girl, finally on the PVC. Sorry, it's upside down. Finally on my PVC. If you haven't done the do, please go and do the do so we can all do the do together and do it. Do. Get your PVC, big. Hello, don't be a waste. That's it. Mwaba. PVC is the way. Yes, your girl, finally on the PVC. Sorry, it's upside down. Finally on my PVC. If you haven't done the do, please go and do the do so we can all do the do together and do it. Do. Get your PVC, big. Hello, don't be a waste. That's it. Mwaba. PVC is the way. Yes, your girl, finally on the PVC. Sorry, it's upside down. Finally on my PVC.
Listen to the new voters card, eh? Wono ojore loju bi. Amo ko wa lo. To ba si fe lo ko laju ele ko mu eyan kan. To ba si mu eyan kan ko dibo fun. Ko si da bobo ibo re o. Protect your vote. O se sans autant le. One love.
So you registered to vote. You should be very, very proud, because that card that you hold in your hand has the power to change this nation one vote at a time. So, very simple. Select, vote, and protect, and do it very wisely. Yes, we are so amazing. That's the least we shall be.
Give them power, so make we shine our eyes well. Anything we feel do, make we do.
After voting for election, stay awake, engage your lawmakers, sign petitions if needed.
Amplify the issue on social media, anywhere and everywhere. Little drop of water makes a mighty ocean.
Remember, the office of the citizen is the highest office in the land.
Bam!
I beg, make them two plates.
Yes, my people, you have the power to change what you don't want in your society. We are the ones with the power. Let us always speak up against injustice as active citizens. The office of the citizen is the highest office in the land. Natu Baba Dehi Asu, and I endorse this message.
I am a citizen of Nigeria. I live and work in Nigeria.
I believe in an open, transparent, and accountable government. I be how you see am.
Now, so millions and billions we dey hear inside suck away, taken abroad, illegal allowances, budget padding. What it don't do?
See. Maybe government, president or senators get power. Now we the citizens, mm-hmm. because
now we
vote them in now. Now we give them power. So make we shine our eyes well. Anything we feel do, make we do.
After voting for election, stay awake, engage your lawmakers, sign petitions if needed.
Amplify the issue on social media, anywhere and everywhere. Little drop of water makes a mighty ocean.
Remember, the office of the citizen is the highest office in the land.
Bam! Pepper soup!
I beg, make them two plates.
Yes, my people, you have the power to change what you don't want in your society. We are the ones with the power. Let us always speak up against injustice as active citizens. The office of the citizen is the highest office in the land. Natu Baba Dehi Asu, and I endorse this message.
I am a citizen of Nigeria. I live and work in Nigeria. I believe in an open, transparent, and accountable government. Abi, how you see am?
Now, so millions and billions we dey hear inside suck away.